Cougars ready to open the 2015 college football season right here at Darcy Stadium under the lights. Well, we'll have them on shortly, but beautiful sunshine right now. Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Parsons. Sean McBride with me as well. Sean, a lot of anticipation comes with the season opener. Such is the case with the University of St. Francis Cougars. This is season number 18, if you can believe that. And most of Cougar football's rich history is built on success, but not so much last year when St. Francis went just 6-5. Now, for some teams, that is a winning season, a reason for celebration. Not so for Cougar fans.
Well, you're exactly right, Joe. This is the winningest program in the state of Indiana, and 6-5 is simply unacceptable. One of the good things for the Cougars this year, they've had a great recruiting class. There's a lot of young talent that has come into the program and really looks to make a difference early on. And so we're expecting a lot out of the Cougars this year.
Let's take a look at some of the positives for USF. Very good pass-receiving nucleus returns led by Cam Smith. I know him. You know him very well, Seth Coate. And the Cougars were number 3, in fact, a year ago in passing offense in the Mid-States Football Association defensively. USF's top sacker returns in defensive end Carrington Thompson, local kid out of Snyder. Also its top interception leader in Cale Tabler. Good nucleus to build around.
Well, you're exactly right. They did lose some talent there. They lost 5 on defense, of course. But, again, these are some big names with some big pedigree associated to them. And they're looking to make an impact early on and take some true team leadership. When we look at the offensive core, Cam Smith, obviously, out of Bishop Dwenger, Coate out of Homestead, some great local talent here on display at Bishop Darcy Stadium.
St. Francis hosts the Olivet Nazarene Tigers, who opened collegiate play actually a week ago, holding off Midland University of Nebraska 27-21. Cougars and Tigers have not met since 2010, when USF went to Bourbonnais and beat ONU 63-7. Tigers, though, in our inaugural season back in 1998, won 28-24.
2-1 overall. Cougars have the edge there as far as that goes, Joe, and a big win, obviously, last time. So we're hoping to get a repeat here, make it maybe a little more interesting, obviously, if you're calling the game. But, yeah, we expect some big things out of the Cougars today against the Tigers.
St. Francis and Olivet Nazarene here tonight. Cougars hoping to get off to a very good start to open the season. And we'll step out for a break and then check back in with Cougar head coach Kevin Daly when our pregame presentation continues. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Okay, kids, we're off and running. I'm going to pot us down. And then out of the spot, we'll be going into Coach D's interview. Well, here we go. Let's check in with head coach Kevin Donnelly. He's the only head coach that the Cougar football program has ever known, and now we head in, coach, in the year 2015. Another season of exciting Cougar football, and trying to come off a 6-5 year. You know, I think it's ironic. I was looking the other day, and a lot of programs, some schools, you go 6-5, you got a winning record. They're doing flip-flops. They're celebrating, but the bar is raised rather high here at St. Francis, and I know your goal is to compete not only for a league championship or national honors year in and year out. Tell me about the offseason, getting ready for today's opener. How and you and your coaches work to try to make this team better?
Well, obviously there's a sense of urgency. 6-5 is not acceptable here. We talk about tough schedule, yada, yada, okay. But bottom line is we had to work harder. It had to be more important. There has to be more passion. And between January until we started camp in August, you could see there was a significant difference. Last summer, we averaged about 9 or 10 kids every day in our summer strength program. Guys have summer jobs, and some have to go back home and so forth. But we averaged close to 60.
Ladies and gentlemen, please.
Where guys made
at this time, we ask you to stand as we get thanks to our local police,
we're looking at
fire, and EMS workers in attendance at today's game, courtesy of Midwest American Federal Credit Union.
Time All Americans returning.
Our colors here are presented by the color guard of the Fort Wayne Police Department.
So it's kind of like starting over again, and we're excited to do that.
Well, the good news, you got a good nucleus of returners, pass receivers coming back. You're led by Cam Smith, and Seth Coate is also in the mix as well. A lot of that's predicated on the ability to get the ball to him, and Nick Ferrer, now a year older. Tell me what you see from him. You know, he showed some real flourishes of brilliance last year at times.
Mm-hmm. Well, he's got a great arm. He's got the height, you know, for good vision. He needs to make the decision and get the ball out of his hand instead of trying to overthink it. You know, he's not going to be a scramble guy. He needs to make the decision, cut it loose. Pass protection is continually getting better. I think we've got a great support cast in the receiving crew and in the running backs. I think we've got four kids at running back that can carry the mail. So excited about that. Defensively, we're young. I mean, we got nine players tonight making their first college start, four freshmen, one true freshman. So we're young. We're excited to play. We're going to make mistakes, but we're going to play harder.
You mentioned on the defensive side, you get Carrington Thompson back. I think he led you in sacks a year ago, and Kael Tabler at safety had five interceptions. Are they your team leaders this year defensively?
Well, it's funny you should say that. I named captains yesterday, and Carrington Thompson and Kael Tabler were the two that I had selected to be the defensive co-captains. And then Seth Stewart and Cam Smith on offense. So those are our four captains.
Let's talk about Olivet Nazarene. We haven't seen them since 2010. They did play a week ago. They won their ball game against Midlands of Nebraska 27-21. What do you see on film about the Tigers?
Well, they play hard. We went out to see a game and pressed a great special team to do a great job, play hard. Got some guys back that didn't play a year ago. They got a big, strong power running back, and they got tackling. They got two quarterbacks. They got one that's a thrower, and they have one that they like to run the zone option with. So they have some playmakers, got some kids that can make plays on the perimeter. Their defense, they're 3-4, but, man, their pressure, they bring it. Their idea of pass coverage.
National anthem would be sung by our own.
So we've had to work a great deal on the blitz and trying to pick that up.
Coach Kevin Downley with his pregame thoughts here before the kickoff against Nazarene University. Cougars 6-5 a year ago, 4-2 in the Mideast League, trying to improve. We'll be back in 60 seconds. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3.
At the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bomb first. That our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the
everybody. I'm Joe Parson. Sean McBride is with me tonight. He'll be down on the field for the opening of the meeting in midfield and the coin toss coming up with our referee tonight. That's Randy Effner. 83 degrees here just ahead of kickoff under sunny skies, and what a difference, what an improvement from what we saw even here late this afternoon with a lot of raindrops. But I couldn't ask for a better evening for a kickoff college football Saturday night here in Fort Wayne. It winds out of the east southeast, very light, about 3 miles an hour. As we mentioned, this Olivet Nazarene Tiger team, head coached by Brian Fish. He's in his fifth year. A year ago, they were just 2-9, 1-4 in the MSFA Midwest League. They lost Their first of four games and eight of their first nine, but they lost three of those games by 7 points or fewer. And they were missing a number of players, key skill position players that have been due to injury, and many of those have played last week and will play again here this evening against losing pros. One of those was a senior quarterback who came in and completed six of 19 passes last week for 74 yards. Did not have a touchdown pass, so it was picked off once. But he also ran 22 times for 45 yards and scored a couple of touchdowns. That is 5'10 senior quarterback Zach Gross. Again, missed much of last year due to injury. And another running back we're expecting to see him 25 times against Midland for 117 yards is David Payne. He's a 5'9 senior, 199 pounds. As far as St. Francis, 6-5 a year ago, 4-2 in the past league. Number Kevin Donnelly in his 18th year. Cougars did win four in a row toward the end of the season to make a bid for the playoffs, but that would end in that season ending loss at Murray, 51-18. Right tackle, and look at a year ago, going 2-4 to begin the 2014 season, Cam St. Smith. Francis did win the four straight games, including really a pivotal victory over couple of top 20 ranked teams, USF, Illinois, and then really a great season in Chicago against Robert Morris to make a bid for a share back of the MSFA Mideast League title, but that would end at Marion, as we mentioned. MSFA top 10 receiver Cam Smith returns for his senior season after leading USF with 47 catches, 836 receiving yards to go with seven touchdowns. And seven touchdowns did rate as the top pass receiving touchdown statistic for USF. And 6'4 junior Seth Coate, they tell me he's added 15 pounds as he's also back after five touchdown catches a year ago. Randy Effner is our referee. We're having the march to midfield, and we will have the introduction of the co-captains and the coin toss. Sean McBride down on the field. Let's go down and pick up the introductions.
Good luck. Introduce yourself, Dylan.
You speaking?
Good evening, gentlemen. Welcome, Olivet. You are the visitors. There's tails. There's heads. Please call it. He's called tails. It is tails. You're going to make your choice this half or defer the second? They're going to defer. St. Francis, receive? They'd like to receive. Which goal would you like to defend? Please turn around, Dylan.
Okay, Joe, the coin toss is over. Olivet is deferred to the second half, and they will defend the south goal. Back up to you.
Okay, we'll be back for the kickoff coming up after this 30-second timeout, and into the game, the 2015 season about to begin. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Sir, then we're good to go. I think we still owe you a live read. We'll get that in right before kickoff.
The officials this evening, the referee, Randy Eckner, the umpire, Brian Fedge, linesman, Jeremy Huckstep, line judge, Jeff Gilstrap, side judge, Ron Cherry, field judge, Jim Toth, and the back judge, Brandon Bushy. Gaskin and Cody Appenzeller deep to the Cougars. Nick Paquette teaming it up for the Olivet.
Welcome back to Darcy Stadium, everybody, with Sean McBride. I'm Joe Parson. Olivet Nazarene won the toss, deferred. They'll kick away from right to left. Cougars will return the kick out of the north end zone. Charles Gaston is back deep out of Bishop Lures. 8 kickoff returns a year ago, had a long of 46. Cody Appenzeller is back there, a dangerous threat as well. He had a return a year ago of 48 yards. Here we go, getting ready. Here comes the kick, and it's down the middle, end over end. Looks like it'll come to Appenzeller. Fumbles it away, picks it up at the 5. Stumbles again, brings it across the 10 to the 15, and fights his way out to the 20-yard line. So USF a little bit of theatrics there. A little anticipation. Everybody's nervous, Sean. It's opening night.
Opening night on the first game of a brand new field turf, Joe. So we're going to blame that one on the field turf right there.
I tell you what, it is a beautiful sight, though. Big investment when you put on these artificial surfaces, but really looks great. So here we go. It'll be first and 10. Ferrer will set up at quarterback. Now a sophomore, the 6'5 sophomore, 225-pounder, play action fake. He wants to throw and throws the fade. He's got Cam Smith at the 40, at the 30. One play and a touchdown coming up. Do you believe it? 80 yards at the 14-42 mark. That's a pretty good way to start.
Unbelievable.
Here.
Right to the playmaker on the first play, and they scorch him early. What a beautiful play and set up that time from Ferrer to Cam Smith, the leading touchdown scorer on the reception side there. Cougars on the board early.
Well, Ferrer on the money, and Cam Smith got behind the defense. And what a start. 6-0 USF.
Cam easily had a 3-yard bubble right there, Joe, and it paid off in spades.
Extra point coming up. Ryan Nix trying to make it a 7-0 lead. We'll wait for the snap. Here's the kick on the way, end over end, on the way, and it is good.
Well, folks, if you can hear this game, it's thanks to our communications sponsor, Dr. Todd and Mary Briscoe in Briscoe Family Dentistry. Their generous financial support helps make this Redeemer Radio Sports broadcast possible. If you need emergency dental care, call Dr. Briscoe at 260-486-9950.
Pretty good start. We'll take a quick 30-second timeout. We'll be back with the Cougar kickoff. Cougar football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM.
I need a little more gear here.
Notre Dame will be a live read in this.
Ryan Nix teeing it up for the Cougars.
Back at Darcy Stadium with Sean McBride. Well, I tell you what, a lot of people aren't even into the stadium yet, and took him just one snap of the football, and Ferrer on the money, Alvin Cam Smith. Deep. You know, he caught that ball about midfield and was in a foot race, and nobody really was near him, Sean.
Right, that's exactly right. He created a 3-yard bubble right there. That's Cam Smith on display. We're hoping to see a lot of him this year.
Chuck Deloach back deep in kick return for Olivet Nazarene. High end over end kick. That one is short though and is fielded on the fly at the 10. Return across the 15-20. And it's a good return up across the 25, close to the 30-yard line for the Tigers. So here come ONU with their first snap from scrimmage. But that's got to be a little bit deflating when you come in and you see your opponent score one play, one touchdown for 80 yards.
Yeah, 13 seconds has expired off the clock, and they're already down 7 points. So the Tigers coming in with their backs up at this point. Let's see what the offense can do.
And we'll check the starting offensive line. Here's a little motion by Deloach from left to right behind the line of scrimmage. They want to run the ball, but there's nothing there. St. Francis, that interior defense, looking at Christian Johnson in the middle. Jeffrey Jones, now a year older, a senior. Carrington Thompson up front. Lucas Sparks. That'll be a loss of one. Second down and 11. Dropping to throw. Here's Matt Ray. Matt Ray, the young sophomore, nobody home. He was looking to the out. Somebody ran along a pattern or miscommunication, but now suddenly it's going to be third down and 11.
I think that was a curl to the outside. The receiver actually curled inside there, Joe, so obviously he threw it into nobody there.
David Payne's in the backfield. They run a two-back set, the Tigers do. He's a 199-pound senior. Had a big ball game, ran for 117 yards last week at home against Midland of Nebraska. They need 11 trying to get out to the 40-yard line on this snap of the ball. Cougars with two safeties back. Here's a left-handed throw near side. They've got to catch and then a drop. So it's a tough start as they try to get the ball to Alvin Best.
Looks like we have a flag on the play there too, Joe. So this one might be a procedure penalty against the offense. Let's see what happens here. Flag near the line of scrimmage.
Randy Effner is our referee here tonight as far as penalties. Olivet Nazarene had 13 for 130 yards despite winning that ballgame 27-21.
Illegal formation. Number 17 was covered by number 10 on the offense. That's declined. Fourth down.
So penalty against ONU. Cougars declined that. Interesting as far as penalties, these two teams led the MSFA. A year ago, ONU had averaged only 37.5 yards a game in penalties. They were number one, and St. Francis averaged 44 yards a game. They were number two. But now the Tigers have got to kick it away. Cale Tabler is back deep, waiting at the 39 penalty flag, and it's blocked. The ball's picked up, and Cougars will have it down inside the 15 at about the 11-yard line.
Flag on the field.
There's a penalty flag, though. Hold on.
We had a Cougar racing off the field trying to beat that snap, and I don't know if he did it, Joe.
Well, that would be just tragic because they had the block of the kick, so we'll wait for Randy Effner to sort this out. But you would think that perhaps that does not bode well for the block kick to stand up and the Cougars to be in the red zone trying to expand to their 7-0 lead here in the early going.
You know, it's one of those things, you know, first game of the season for the Cougars, you know, early season jitters. Let's see what the call is.
Illegal substitution.
Yep.
Number 93 did not get off the field in time. That's a 5-yard penalty. Replay, fourth down.
So that does cost them the block kick and the great field position. It's fourth down and six, and still they'll be forced to kick.
Fourth and six.
Looks like Andrew Hunt was credited with that block kick, but all for naught.
Let's see if they can do it again.
Cougars with 10 men up the line of scrimmage once again. And here's the right-footed kick this time. It's a low line drive kick, takes a bounce, and Tabler will pick that up. What a hit he took. I mean, a head-high hit, and did he hold on to the ball?
I don't think he did, Joe.
No. Took a chance, and ONU's got the ball at the Cougar 31-yard line. And I tell you what, Cale is going to wonder, what was the number of that truck that just hit him?
Boy, oh boy, he took a shot, and he got separated
Fumble
from the ball.
Fumble on the play, covered by Olivet. First down.
Boy. Well, they go from a block punt, and now ONE has a fresh set of downs inside Cougar territory.
They'll mark it at the 32-yard line, so the offense and Matt Ray comes back onto the field. David Payne stays in as the running back. And Chuck Deloach, who had three carries for 23 yards last week, is also in the ball game, wide to the left side. Pistol alignment now for Ray. Ray with Payne hands the ball to him. No, they want the throw off, and that's a ball thrown low. And let's see, that is going to be caught apparently up across the 30, right back about at the 28. Now they rule it incomplete. It hit the turf. It was a low ball. It was going to be a tough catch in any event. So incomplete.
Falls on the St. Francis 32.
Second down coming up, second down and 10. 13:43 remains here in the opening quarter. In case you just join us, the Cougars one play after the kickoff, 80 yards and a touchdown, and Payne is stacked up for a loss trying to come back on second effort, but he's going to lose at least a yard. And the man in the middle, that was Jeffrey Jones. They got penetration across the defensive line.
Yeah, the nose tackle for the Cougars did a nice slant, filling in the gaps.
Number 69, right at the help came off. He's out for a play. Reset the play clock to 25 seconds, please.
Oh, you don't have any problems hearing that, do you?
Yeah, sure don't.
That's our hearing test for the night. We all
right.
Passed.
Yeah. Again, the front three for the the front four for St. Francis doing a nice job penetrating there, being right there at the transaction, resulting in a loss of 1.5, maybe 2 yards.
Third down and 12 now. Ray drops the throw, screens the ball right side. Payne's got it, cuts to the 30-yard line. He won't pick up the first down as he goes out of bounds on the far side. This is a big offensive line for the Tigers. They average 292 a man, tackle to tackle. Zane Bertrand at center. Trevor Thomas, Chris Eshelman are the guards, and Jorge Valencia, along with Danny Sullivan, are the tackles. But fourth down and nine, they're going to roll the dice and go for it. No field goal coming up. They were Two for two on field goals last week. High snap. Here's a left-handed throw, and that's caught. And short of a first down, let's see, second effort. Let's see if they got it. Going to be close out there on fourth down. Depends on the spot of the ball.
Great second effort that time by the Tiger out there.
ONU feels they've got it. No indication from the officials. Referee Randy Effner is out there taking a look.
Real close for number 82, Rashawn Gammon, 5'11", 185-pound freshman out there on second effort. Bounces out of one tackle, dives for the stick. Looks like they're going to measure this one,
I think they're going to bring out the stick, says Sean. We'll maybe have a moment for this.
While we talk about that, let's talk about Notre Dame Federal Credit Union, ladies and gentlemen. You can help support your Catholic parish or school and help yourself in the process with Notre Dame Federal Credit Union's Elevate program. Call Elevate at 844-230-6611 or visit them online at ndelevate.com.
Well, Kale Tabler is going to feel a little bit better right now because the fourth down bid came up short. So St. Francis gets the ball back. No harm, no foul. It'll be first and 10 for USF at their own 22-yard line. And two safeties back this time for the Tigers. And you think they're going to be looking for 84?
I think so. Looks like Cam Smith is going to be split out wide to the right on this play.
Yusuf Haddad has got the coverage, and he's going to have some help. But the Cougars show three wide to the right. Long count from the line of scrimmage by Ferrer. St. Francis leads it 7-0. Deep handoff, stretch run, and some running room off to the right for Aaron Harris as he cuts across the 30-yard line, brought it up to the 32-yard line. Aaron Harris getting the call carried a year ago for 37 times for 173 yards. Average, Sean, over 4.5 yards a carry, and ran into the end zone one time.
Well, and this was a question, you know, coming into this contest, the O-line up front for St. Francis, and they performed beautifully there. They're going up a 3-4 defense with Olivet right there. Great hole, off tackle right, and they made it hurt.
Seth Code is also on the field as he's part of a two-wide alignment to the wide side. To the left, there was movement of the line of scrimmage. They reset. Play clock is at 10. Ferrer barking out the signals once again. ONU threatens blitz. Ferrer still ready to take the snap. We're down to three. We're down to two. Harris up the middle. He's got the first down. Nor did he. He almost did. He fumbled the ball away.
He did.
He was just about to reach the first down stick, and the Cougars already have fumbled twice. ONU will have the ball again into Cougar territory. First and 10 at the 44-yard line.
I believe that was Lucas Lindbergh, number 21, that caused that fumble. Got a helmet on the ball, and it just popped right out. And once again, Olivet coming up. That's a second turnover on the day for St. Francis.
Well, the defenses look pretty good. They'll be called on once again now to stand tall. As we'll take a look at that defensive alignment, fourth Deloach in motion. Here's a spin to the left and a throw. They've got a catch, but Payne is wrapped up. They'll lose yardage. Great coverage as coming up for St. Francis. Jalen McIntyre had five tackles and a fumble recovery a year ago.
You know, McIntyre right there read that play beautifully. They did a little play action to try and suck in the defense, and he played them straight up.
Quick hitting play. They run Payne up the middle. He runs into a wall but fights his way down to the 40-yard line. They'll gain about two, maybe 3 yards to bring up third down. Third and 7, we'll call it. On third downs a year ago, ONU, well, last week they were 4 of 18 on third downs. As far as 2014 numbers, 41 of 156 for just 26%. And that was right at the bottom. Here's Ray wanting to throw again. Looks far side. He's got a man. He's got a catch for a first down.
It's going to be close, but I think when he stretched, he will have just inches, maybe a yard, to get one. Number 16 on the catch that time, Matt McDivitt. Doing a fine job reaching the sticks and moving the chains.
Spencer Coward on the, had the coverage assignment, 26 tackles a year ago, had one quarterback hurry.
Oh, there's a flag down, Joe.
Didn't see that, so we'll check our referee, Randy Effner, once again.
Holding, number 68 on the offense. That's a 10-yard penalty. Replay, third down.
6'5", junior Dan Sullivan, who goes 285, caught holding. So it'll be a walk-off, and instead of a first down, they'll replay the down, third down, but that ball will come back to midfield. So now they've got to get to the 33-yard line of St. Francis.
Well, it's critical to make something off of these turnovers, and so far Olivet has not had the opportunity to do that. Mistakes and coming up short so far on these two turnovers, but they do have the ball near the midfield stripe.
Ray, a week ago, started, was just 2 of 6 through the air. He's been committed to throw in the ball, steps up the pocket, throws over the middle, and that ball is it picked off, or that's incomplete?
Nearly, but no, it's incomplete. Jalen McIntyre, again, number five, right there at the point of the catch, and the ball is deflected, no good.
So it'll be fourth down, and now the Tigers will kick the ball away, trying to play field position. Son of factor, as you look back down there, it looks like Jarrell Holman out there for a moment, but shielding his eyes. And Cale Taylor is back in punt return. What must be going through his mind?
Yeah, maybe fair catch. Might be a valid option here. We'll see.
So the punter, and let's see who will be back. They used two punters. Each had four punts a week ago. The ball is dropped. And that is, I believe, David Payne to punt the ball. And Taylor knows going to run the ball, brings it back to the 15, cuts to his left, gets by one, cuts to the 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, up the midfield, nearly and out of bounds. And Cale Taylor says, right back at you.
That's exactly right. Look at that impressive run that time by Taylor, taking it from inside his own 20, taking it all the way out to ONU territory, right at the 49-yard line. Athleticism on display right there by team captain Tabler.
As you mentioned, they'll mark it 1 yard on the ONU side of midfield, so it's first and 10 at the 49-yard line. Offensive line for St. Francis averaging 280 a man, Brian Gegner. And at center, Zach Minardo and Gus Hancock are the guards. Keegan Bruner and Alex Woods starting today. Woods, a newcomer, a sophomore at 6'2", 261. And Ferrer back in there at quarterback, out of the pistol. Waiting for the snap from center. He's got that. Wants to know the draw's coming up and hands the ball off. There's Harris looking for running room, and he finds it for a first down as he carries it into ONU territory inside the 35, down close to the 34, depending on the spot of the ball.
Fantastic downfield block here by left tackle Alex Woods, number 75, 6'2", 261, gives the running back, Aaron Harris, at least another 5 or 6 yards on that run.
Sean, that was one of the areas we talked about needing improvement from a year ago. And again, take this with a bit of a grain of salt. Cougar offensive line gave up 36 sacks. That's not all on them alone.
Right.
Here's a little handoff, and Harris looking for running room, breaking tackles again, and powers his way off tackle, angling down to the 25 as he lost his helmet. There's a penalty flag, though.
Yeah, we've got a flag down on the opposite side of the hash mark there on the left side of the field. Harris is going to have to come off with the helmet removed during that play. This one, well, Ferreira's pointing against Olivet. Let's see what happens here.
By the way, that'll bring Justin Green. They've been talking about the redshirt freshman, 5'11", 186, and we may see his first carry of the day coming up shortly. We had one final from earlier in the day in the Mid-States Football Association. It was St. Ambrose. They did win over Concordia, but get this score, 25-21. So Concordia coming a long way from what we've seen the last several years.
Number 37 is out for one play as his helmet came off. Personal foul, number 89 on the white. Hands to the face, that's half the distance to the goal line. First down.
That was Ron France, their talented 6'5 senior defensive end, who had four block kicks a year ago and one block kick last week. So frustration getting the better part of the Tigers in the early going as USF will have it first and goal. First and 10, I should say, just outside the 12-yard line.
Denver Chrysler Jeep, first down.
Nose of the football just inside the 13.
First and 10 from the Tiger 13.
Seth Stewart in. He's up on the wing to the left side. Running back is Justin Green. Here's Ferrer. He's got two wide, two of the right. Little motion now by Appenzeller, and they pitch the ball to him. Appenzeller trying to turn the corner, got to the 10, got to the 5, looking for the pylon. And did he get in? No indication yet. Touchdown. One play, one touchdown again after the penalty. And then one good for 13 yards at the 10-12 mark, and Appenzeller into the end zone to make it 13-0.
Well, a tremendous job by Ferrer there on that little quick pitch. I honestly thought the quarterback still
sold
had it. Yeah, he really did. Sold it like a carpetbagger there. And, boy, what speed on display by Appenzeller to get around that corner, make the cut, and hit that pylon.
You know, I think that counts as a pass completion for Ferrer and a touchdown as well. And now Ryan Nix on to attempt the extra point. He was 35 of 41 a year ago in extra points, 9 of 13 in field goals. Actually led St. Francis in scoring with 62 points, and he looks to add his second one here of the night, and he does. So timeout at Darcy Stadium, and things going well, all things considered. The opener, 14-0 USF. This is Cougar Football on 3D Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM.
25 years with patient-friendly dentistry. Visit Afton for all of your needs.
Did you get that Notre Dame read in?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Yeah, when they were doing the measurements. Over there.
Nothing USF with Sean McBride. I'm Joe Parson, and Cougars showing a little creativity with their play calling.
Well, very much, and it's apropos, honestly, because what the defense has done for the offense so far has really stymied Olivet Nazarene, because, again, the Cougars so far are two turnovers, but yet they're up by two scores.
Yes.
So what that means is the defense is holding and giving the offense another opportunity, and they've really made it pay as far as that goes. Of course, the penalties against ONU, three of them so far, and that was a big killer, that personal foul that put him inside the red zone.
Rashawn Gaiman is back in kick return, waiting at the goal line. He had two kickoff returns a week ago. I had a long of 72, so you got to be aware of that. 14-0 Cougars. Nick's getting ready to tee it up and kick it away from his own 35-yard line. Gets the go-ahead from the official. And we're about ready to play football again. Driving end-over-end kick. And Gaiman has got it at the 3. Brings that across the 5 to the 10. 15. Gets away from one. Up the middle. He's got running room. Now he's across the 35 to the 40. One man to beat. Nick's knocks him down. He got enough. But it's a good return all the way to the 45 of USF. If it stands up, is there a flag down there?
There is, on the far side of the field near the 40, Joe. So let's see if this play stands. But boy, oh boy, Rashawn Gaiman, number 82 that time. Boy, he's got some talent, some skills, and some speed. Taking it all the way into St. Francis territory from the 3-yard line.
Again, we'll get the call on the field from Randy Eppner, our referee.
On the return, on the kicking team, 10-yard penalty for holding. First and 10.
Well, the Tigers under Brian Fish were so good a year ago in avoiding penalties. They led the MSFA, but not here so far today on the road against USF.
Looks like the play was called, the penalty was called at the 37, so they'll mark it back to the 27-yard line.
It will be first and 10 Tigers. And let's see if they've made a change at quarterback. They do still have Ray in there. He'll hand the ball up the middle. And boy, USF waiting there. Big boys Jeffrey Jones and Christian Johnson not allowing much, if any.
If any, yeah. I think they got it back to the line of scrimmage, and that's about it.
Second down and 10. Ray, play action fake, wants to throw. Looks short, threw it wide, incomplete. Was looking right at the line of scrimmage, I believe, to Chuck Deloach. But that's incomplete, and just like that, in a matter of just a few seconds, it's third and 10.
Spencer Coward got to the quarterback that time just as he was releasing the ball from his outside linebacker position, and that may have influenced it, but bad pass.
ONU trying to play a little up-tempo now. Now they slow things down. Still plenty of time on the play clock. And Ray takes the snap. Play action fake again. Wants the throw. Looks right, throws right, and got a catch out there up around the 37, right at the first down stick. They'll call that a catch. And that's going to be good for a first down. As coming up with that ball for ONU was number 5. That's Adam Blanders. Blanders, a sophomore wide receiver, a 6'1 out of Elkhart, Indiana. And again, the quick hitting play. They want to run the ball up across the 40 to about the 41-yard line. You know, more and more you see teams, coaches, to play fast, up the tempo, try to keep the defense a little bit off balance.
Well, and even on the previous play, the defense was not set for that play on that pitch and catch that time, giving them the first down.
A little motion left to right behind the line of scrimmage. They'll hand the ball off on a sweep coming, and they're turning the corner, and they've close to another first down. They've got some new numbers in there now working for the Tigers.
Matt McDivitt,
a junior wideout on the sweep. Takes the inside handoff, turns the corner right side, and he's a yard from a first down.
Now, nice carry that time, good execution. He found some speed around the end and made that cut. And, again, they put him up in real position. On third and one, you can really open up the playbook right here, Joe. And let's see what Olivet Nazarene does.
And as you well know, Sean, what do they say when you're up front, especially defensive end? You've got to contain.
Got to.
Try to keep him inside. That time, McDivitt able to go wide right around the corner. Motion again. Left to right behind the line of scrimmage. Here's a little spin play, and then, boy, I tell you what, Ray has three blue jerseys bearing down on him. He tried to dump that ball off to Michael Ho Lewis, but no time there, and it's fourth and one, And I would guess, trailing at 14-0, 8:29 remaining in the opening quarter, that the Tigers may be tempted to go for it with the ball just short of midfield.
Yeah, they might very well. They're looking to the sidelines to get some guidance here. The offense is still on the field. It looks like they will try and go for it here.
Glanders stays in. He's wide to the right. Motion back by Glanders to the near side now. That's the wide side to the left of Matt Ray. Ready to take the snap. Fumbled the ball for a moment. Throws it off the left hand of the cut. The deep post by Adam Flanders. No good. So the Cougars hold on fourth down. They'll get the ball over and take it over on downs. And they'll have great field position at the ONU 47.
Another impressive outing by the Cougar defense right there. And putting stiff backs and putting a lot of pressure on the quarterback when necessary to force that turnover on downs. And now that gives the Cougar offense really short field position coming into this possession.
So St. Francis, Kevin Downey's got to be pleased with his defense. They've had a pair of fourth down stops. And now they take over the ball with excellent field position. Seth Cote comes onto the field. And let's see if that's Appenzeller in the slot to the right. Seth Stewart split wide of him. I believe I've got that number wrong. I'll check that for you. But it's still Ferrer at quarterback. And he looks to throw again on first down. Time of the pocket, flush to his right. Sets his feet, throws down. He's got Montay McDowell, has the ball for a moment, and he's got a touchdown. He did not control it.
He did.
Rule it. Maybe they rule it. He had long enough.
I think, Joe, what happened, we did get a touchdown confirmation from an official because he was stretched over the plane with the ball, and it came became separated when he hit the turf.
I think we've been so accustomed to that you've got to maintain control to the ground, but that may be just an NFL rule. So it will be 20-0 on that 47-yard touchdown pass, and Ferrer's looking good tonight.
Boy, is he ever. And a great great presence there by the receiver to carry that ball through the end zone plane and get a score.
Montay McDowell with the catch, and here's the extra point by Nix, and through the uprights it is good. So 21-0 will keep things right here as St. Francis offensively, they've had an opening one-play score. Ferrer to Cam Smith, and most recently 47 yards on the touchdown catch by Montay McDowell, and that's going to give the 6'2 junior some confidence. He had just one catch a year ago for 14 yards, and that does it increases stat, you might say.
Well, that's in a big way, obviously. And again, great presence and situational awareness by Ferrer as he was flushed out of the pocket. He rolls to his right, loads up, and fires down the field. Now, the good thing about that, Montay McDowell, I think the safety sucked in a little bit when he saw that the quarterback Ferrer was released from the pocket. He should have stayed with his receiver, but was paying attention to the quarterback. McDowell gets behind him, and that is a 6-point score for the Cougars.
21 unanswered points here to start this ball game in the first quarter. We still have about half the first period, 8:15 remaining. And once again, it'll be Ryan Nix to kick the ball away from left to right. Remember, ONU won the toss deferred, so they'll get the ball to start in the second half. But so far, the USF offense looking very crisp.
I hate to say, Joe, but it's getting late early for the Tigers from all appearances here. Down 3 scores in the first quarter. Wow.
See if Gaiman's back deep in the kick return. End-over-end kick going his way. Runs up to it at the 1. Works right side to the 5, to the 10, 15, 20. 25, he's got running room down the right sidelines across the 30 and out of bounds around the 32-yard line. So again, St. Francis will see the Tigers go to work offensively. And they're going to stay with 6'1 sophomore Matt Ray, at least the start of this series, trailing at 21-0.
Tigers take over first and 10 on their own 32.
Yeah, let's see if that's still David Payne in there as the running back.
I think they're going to have to try and take advantage of this aggressive front four by St. Francis. And how you do that is with counters and traps. But again, a stout linebacker core in there for St. Francis as well. So let's see what the Tigers can do here on offense.
Ray rolls to his right, wants the throw. Left-handed, the thrower has a completion. And again, we were watching in the warm-ups a lot of short little button hook down and out patterns, really possession type of passing game. You know, you try to dink and dive and maybe pick up 5 or 6, and they do pick up 6 on that throw.
Again, out to Gammon, number 82, who was wide on the right side, little button hook, and it is successful, gets some positive yards.
One back look. So second down, here is Ray, play action fake, wants to throw, dances, throws over the middle, and that ball That was Glanders. Did he get a foot in bounds? He did. He's got a first down up around the 49-yard line. So Adam Glanders, 6'1 sophomore. Didn't see any numbers for him last week, but he's come to play here tonight. First and 10, and they're ready to go to work again. St. Francis a little slow getting off the field, and that's going to be a substitution penalty again. Got to quicken it up a little bit. So there's only a gain of one on the carry, and we have an injured Tiger down on the field, I believe. So there'll be an injury stoppage, but also there's going to be another late substitution penalty against St. Francis.
I believe that's the second one for that substitution penalty for St. Francis on the night so far.
Other games going on elsewhere today in the MSFA, Siena Heights. They were winning big over Lindenwood. Belleville will be there in a few weeks toward the end of the month. Don't have a final on that one. Night games, Taylor taking on Anderson, a game that starts right about now. And Marion and Missouri Baptist.
We have an illegal substitution. Number 29 on the defense. That's a 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Mentioned Marion and Missouri Baptist were idle today. The other final we had, St. Ambrose did hold on to beat Concordia, Michigan, 25-21.
Trying to get a number on that Tiger down there. Joe is still down on the turf. That might be left guard Chris Ashman. Let's see, I think it's
Dan Sullivan.
Dan Sullivan, 68, not 69. Yeah.
285-pound junior. He has kind of walking off the field under his own power, so we'll see if he's able to return. Meanwhile, the penalty moves. It'll be first and 5. And coaching staff's going to be happy that last snap on the penalty. Cougars getting off the field. We're just kind of loping along, not really rushing to get off. Low snap. Ray picks it up, hands it off. New running back is in there. That's Eric Anderson. He's a 6-foot sophomore at 4 carries for 9 yards last week.
How much there? Gain of inches that time, Joe.
Second down and 5. Ray with Glanders up in the slot to the left side. Too wide to the left. Looking to throw. Here comes the blitz. Screens the ball right side. He's got to catch some running room for a first down. And much more up the middle. They got a chance to score in this inside the 20 to the 10 to the 5 and a touchdown. So the middle was open. And 46 yards on the little short pass play that good for a touchdown. Matt Ray screened the ball in. It was off to the house.
Great blocking set up by the Big Uglies up front for Olivet that time as the screen back through the middle. We also had an outside linebacker coming in on a blitz. So when he got into that linebacker core, there was nobody there, and he was off to the races.
Nick Paquette does most of the extra point kicking. He was 3 for 3 in extra points last week, hit a couple of field goals, trying to get the 7 points. Blocked at the line of scrimmage. And that is the way that will end. So it'll be a 21-6 ball game, still with 6:53 remaining in this opening quarter. And again, we'll keep things right here for the 46-yard pass play from Ray, and that'll give the young 6'1 sophomore some confidence. That is his first collegiate passing touchdown of his career.
Well, and he needs it. You know, they started out rough here, Joe, 21-0 here in the first quarter. They were down, and they were able to put a drive together with a couple first downs. A little penalty helped them there. But again, nice execution on that middle screen and a great 46-yard play.
By the way, that was Rashawn Gaiman on the reception. Good running for 46 yards for the touchdown. So the Tigers are on the board. They're down 15 points here on the road. Looking ahead to next week, we'll be on the road. It'll be another night game as we'll be down to Upland, Indiana. And it'll be a 7 o'clock kickoff against the Taylor University Trojans. And our pregame show will begin 1 week from tonight at 6:45 p.m. on Redeemer Radio. So are the Tigers. They return home to host Lindenwood Belleville next Saturday night. So they've got a night game. It's hard to believe that'll be their third game already of the season come next week.
Right.
Now, let's take note. We were watching Olivet Nazarene practice. A lot of onside kick recoveries. Let's see if the Cougars were kind of being aware of that as well. Would you be tempted to try to go onside still with 6:53 in the first quarter?
It's pretty early in the game. They look like they're in a standard formation. Let's see what happens.
They do kick it high end over end. And USF will have it return from the 10. And here's Appenzeller to the 20, 25, spun around, tries to keep his footing, but holds on to the ball, and it'll be first and 10, USF at the 26, maybe the 27-yard line. Cody Appenzeller last year had 25 kickoff returns. He had a long of 48 yards. He averaged just about 22 yards a kick return. First and 10, USF.
On their own 27.
They've got it at the 27-yard line, leading it 21-6. Nick Ferrer has thrown for two touchdowns already, 80 yards to start the game on the first snap from scrimmage. And most recently, a 47-yard touchdown pass to Montay McDowell. Now Ferrer looking to hand the ball off. Read option, hole right side across the 30. Comes Justin Green, the redshirt freshman. As he rolls across the 30 to the 31-yard line, he'll pick up about 4, maybe 5 yards.
Good presence that time. Off tackle to the right side, and he was able to get a nice successful run. Second and 5 coming up here for Cougars. And you can do a lot on second and 5. Let's see what they do.
You're right, Sean. You really like to pick up 4 or 5 yards on that first down call.
Gives you lots of options.
Let's see if it's Stewart up on the wing to the left side. He's got 2 wide, split wide of him. ONU, did they encroach or did USF move? We'll see. Our umpire is going to make the call down on the field through the penalty flag. And ONU, I don't know what it would show for penalties already, but they have been burned a lot in this first quarter with still 6:14 to play. That one goes against the Blue.
False start. Okay. Number 75 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still second.
Alex Wood's going to be whistled for that procedure call.
We don't have anything officially, but I've been trying to keep track. I think that's 3 on each so far, Joe.
ONU with the timing, though, of their penalties really has hurt them. Coat into the ball game now. Seth Coat wide to the left side. And Sean Boswell is up in the slot to the left side as well. Ferrer out of the pistol once again. ONU threatens blitz. Spin move. Here's Ferrer and throws over the middle. He's got McDowell again, but overshot him. Just overthrew that ball. He had a step. Once again, and Monty had to be thinking, hey, I've got a chance for 2.
Boy, oh boy. And if, you know, Ferrer didn't put a lot of pepper on that one and just sailed it in there, that would have been an easy catch because, again, he had that nice 3-yard bubble. He got behind the safety, but unfortunately the ball was just overthrown.
Just needed a little bit more air for Montay McDowell to run underneath it. But now it's 3rd down and 5. USF on 3rd downs. A year ago, were among the best in the MSFA, number 2, in fact. They were at 42%. Ferrer trying to make a play again. Pulls it down, scrambles to his right, hit and drops. Sacked back inside the 20 at the 18-yard line. And that's one of the things. He didn't want to make a mistake with it, but it is nonetheless a sack. And the Cougar offensive line gave up 36 sacks a year ago, and now they'll have to punt the ball away.
Yeah, Gino Prestia, we're going to call that one a covered sack, Joe, because the inside linebacker was able to get to Ferrer. He had time, but again, a lot of good coverage downfield, and he wasn't able to get rid of the ball.
Deloach is back in punt return at the 35 of ONU, backing up.
Josh McNally in punt formation for the Cougars.
He had 6 punt returns last week, had a long of 45. Got to be aware of him as Spitnail waits at the 5. Kick is away. Got a nice high. Wow, that's above the press box. Deloach will catch the ball and nailed from behind. Wow, what a play coming down hard. And that was Stanford Jackson.
Wow. Welcome to Cougar football. Good heavens, Spitnail. I got to tell you, the Snyder standout, what a kick that time, allowing his defenders to get downfield. And as soon as that young man caught the ball, he was hit.
Well, Josh, a year ago, 51 punts at a long of 69. He averaged nearly 40 yards a punt, and that was a beaut. That takes the clock down to 5 minutes here in the opening quarter, 1st and 10. Cougar defense getting out. They've got all 11 within about 10, 12 yards of line of scrimmage. Ray does hand the ball off, and there's running room up the middle.
Yep.
Across the 35, the carry comes out to about the 39-yard line.
Nice little inside trap that time. Again, taking advantage of the aggressive nature of the front 4 of the St. Francis Cougars, and that was a nice game.
That was Eric Anderson on the carry.
Oh, we got a flag on the far side, Joe.
Well, the officials, this crew working with Randy Effner, have not been shy about throwing some yellow laundry out there in this first quarter. It's taken a while.
Number 97 on the defense, encroachment. That's a 5-yard penalty, still 1.
It's Carrington Thompson went offside. So it'll be first down and 5 with the ball now up at the 39-yard line. Ray working from the left side hash mark. Left-handed passing quarterback, the sophomore, looking to hand the ball off. Nothing there. Got tripped up a little bit, and the ball popped free. Sean Lewis says, hey, we've got the ball for St. Francis, but no, I believe it'll stay in the hands of the Tigers.
Yeah, I think the officials disagree there. But again, nice defensive stop. No real harm, no real foul there.
Second down, still five. Now they flip-flop Glanders to the right side. And they've got a new number out there as well. Motion, Alvin Best takes the handoff. Best looking for running room, finds it, angles for a first down across the 45, got another yard close to the 46.
Nice job by the Tigers that time to flood the wide side of the field with all their skill positions, blow out that lane, and gets them forward for a nice first down.
And they're ready to go to work once again. Best hurries back. He'll be a wide out to the left side now. Nashawn Lewis has got the coverage near side. There is movement again to the line of scrimmage, and they'll run the ball. And that's Eric Anderson trying to go off tackle to his right, gets back to the line of scrimmage, and that is about it.
Cougars having a hard time getting set. This quick count is really not allowing the defense to really get set, looking at their coverages. It looks like we have a Tiger back down on the turf now.
Another man down, and that's a big kid, 325-pound junior tackle, Jorge Valencia. The way he was acting, Sean, it looked like maybe it was a cramp.
Yeah, could very well
very
be.
Very warm evening here in Fort Wayne, 83 degrees at kickoff. Still a lot of sunshine, though, over Darcy Stadium. All the lights have come on. 3:59 remains in the opening quarter. It'll be second down and eight. So they lost some real estate. And Valencia up and trying to stretch out that left leg.
Yeah, it's probably just a cramp, Joe. We'll probably see him again shortly.
Well, Dan Sullivan went out. Always a tough night when you're packing around, 300, 330 pounds. What are you looking at me?
Hey, I didn't say anything.
Second down and
that
long.
That would be the pot calling the kettle black.
Yeah, I hear you. I'm trying. Lord knows I'm trying. Glanders in. He'll set up in the slot to the near side. Best is split wide of him. Cougars with two safeties back, including Cale Taylor. So here we go on second down and long. Ray dropping the throw, looks near side, screens the ball and dropped by Glanders.
Yeah, he was wide out, split out wide to the left and started creeping into the interior line. So they were going to try that middle screen again. But unfortunately, the receiver just dropped the ball. I don't know if he had alligator arms, but it looks like there wasn't going to be much there anyway as the defense was anticipating that call.
Incompletion brings up third down and nine. They must get to the USF 44-yard line on this snap. 21-6, Cougars scored the first 21 points of the ball game. Ray to the air again, flush to his left. He can run. Looks, throws it as far as he can, looking for Best. Best intercepted. Nice cut inside by Cale Tabor. Took the ball away. He played the ball perfectly. And USF gets it back inside their 15-yard line.
Joe, you couldn't have called it better. Tabor, there were two men out there, one on the outside, one on the inside. Tabor had great position, turned just at the exact point in time that he did, turned to the inside, and the ball was right in his breadbasket. Great job by Tabor.
So USF will have it back at their own 14-yard line, and we talked earlier about Cale Taylor being one of the co-captains and leaders of this Cougar defense. Five interceptions a year ago, 69 tackles. And he also led USF with 10 passes defended. So now USF, the good news, they get the ball back, leading at 21-6. The bad news, they're back on their own 14. They show three wide to the right, the short side of the field. Ferrer looking, and there's a little motion there. But no penalty flags and a big hole off tackle again. That'll be a gain out to the 20. The hole closed quickly.
Aaron Harris
found some running room initially.
Really impressed so far, Joe, with the front five for St. Francis on offense. They're not only protecting the quarterback very well, other than one sack, but they're really opening some gaping holes in there for Aaron Harris and company doing the running.
He'll pick up about 6 yards, so second down and four. McDowell is in, wide to the left. Up on the slot, left side is Cody Appenzeller. Appenzeller a big threat as well. Shifting defense alignment and a look by the Tigers as Ferrer with the snap again. Looks near side, throws, now pulls it out. And they did throw the ball. Cam Smith will have the first down across the 25, up short of the 40-yard line. Cam Smith, not quite as electric as that opening play to start the ball game, but they'll take it as USF does get a first down and they move the chains.
And knowing Cam the way we do, he's all about the team, whatever it takes. And that time, all it needed was a first down to keep the chains going and keep the drive alive, and that's exactly what happened.
Cam Smith a year ago, season last year, 7 touchdowns, tops the Cougars in that category, also with 836 receiving yards. First and 10 at the 29. Ferrer looking at a blitz defensive right side. It's picked up now. Steps up and throws the ball over the middle. And Appenzeller reached out and caught the ball. Did he hold on?
I think he caught it. Oh, no. They're waving it off. Oh. And there's also a flag in the backfield. That may be holding against the offense.
Maybe that's why Ferrer was able to avoid the sack.
Right.
Holding. Number 37 on the offense. Holding. It's a 10-yard penalty. Still first down.
Well, Aaron Harris was not about to let his quarterback get sacked back there, and it cost him. So that'll back him up. And it will remain first down, but first down and 20 now with the ball back at the 19-yard line. Seth Coates stays in. He's not yet had a chance to catch the ball. And they've got Sean Boswell back in their left side slot receiver. Here's a screen and off the fingertips, incomplete. They're trying to find Gegner that time on a tight end screen. And another penalty flag is thrown down there.
Yeah, I think it was a great call because, again, these outside linebackers are creeping in on the edge. So what do? You throw the ball where they're no longer at. And that was a great play call that time by the Cougars. Coach Donnelly's hot about something, coming out to the numbers almost.
Yeah. He has a way of getting his view of across.
Yes, indeed. Looks like this is going to move the Cougars back again.
Holding. Number 66 on the offense. Half the distance to the goal line. Still second down.
That's Brian Gignan called for the hold. So it remains first down, but they keep backing up.
First down.
Now that'll move the ball back.
To the nine. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm trying to sort out all those lines. They use this field now for soccer. So first in along, they got to get out to the 39, but they get downs to work with. Here's the ball near side. Smith has got it and bowls his way up to the 20. Takes a tackler up to about the 21, 22-yard line. And so little by little, trying to get a lot of that penalty yardage back. Second down, it looks about, maybe about 20 yards coming up.
Second and 18.
Coming down close to 2 minutes time remaining in this first quarter. First quarter has taken a while because we've had points scored and a lot of penalties as well. USF on the first snap from scrimmage. Good for 80 yards, a touchdown pass to Cam Smith. Ferrer trying to make a play now in second and long. Pump fake, flush to his right. Hits Cam Smith again. Works to the 25, got to the 27. Now they've got to get to the 39 on this next snap on third down coming up with a minute 46 remaining in the quarter.
This is easy for Cam Smith to try and get out of bounds there that time, but instead he turns in and tries to make something happen, some more yards after the catch. He wasn't successful, but still a good catch, and that shows you the drive and determination that he has.
They'll spot that ball at the 28-yard line of St. Francis. Third down and 11 coming up, trying to reach the 39-yard line. Ferrer, ready to bark out the signals once again. Has the snap, spins, looks, takes a look, and runs right into the defender. The ball is free. St. Francis had it, lost it. It'll be first and 10 for ONU at the 15-yard line. Nice defensive maneuver that time. They went to the outside, and Ferrer didn't feel the pressure coming from his backside.
No, that's exactly right. The defender doing that a fine job that time, continuing with the play. He didn't get quit when he was in the backfield. And he actually met Ferrer as he was rolling to his right and got that big paw out there and knocked the ball free. And it was recovered. ONE with new life here, getting ready to end the first quarter.
On the play. It was recovered by Olivet. First down.
They'll have it at the Cougar 12-yard line and try to get closer in a 21-6 ball game. Ray this time is going to work with an offset eye. Two running backs in there. He's about a step in front of either one. A little motion out of it now from left to right. Does hand the ball up the middle. That's David Payne back in there, and he hits a wall right in as well. No gain on that call.
Big stop that time by number 54, Lucas Sparks, defensive end for the Cougars, shaking off his block and getting the running back in the back.
Rashawn Gaiman is in. He's wide to the right side, and Jalen McIntyre's got the coverage. And here is Ray wanting the throw, being pursued, throws it away, up and out of the field of play, looking to the left corner, trying to find a receiver back deep in the left side, but nobody was open. Matt McDivitt was the ostensibly the left, the intended receiver, but no good, and it's third down.
Well, and Deshaun Lewis, the cornerback, was out there right in his face as well, and that would have been a tough catch anyway.
By the way, that previous running play was a net loss, so the ball is outside the 15 at the 18-yard line. Third down and 11. Ray again, short drop, screens the ball, tipped in the air but caught by Glanders, and runs out of a tackle and runs down to the 16-yard line. All in all, that did not get them all that much, but may bring a field goal attempt coming on by the Tigers, and Nick Paquette trying to make it 21-9 if he can.
Great fundamentals by Jeffrey Jones, a nose tackle right there, getting some pressure there, getting his paws up and knocking that ball. Instead of a straight shot pass, it got looped into the air and gave a second or two for the defense to pursue that ball.
This will be a 33-yard field goal attempt, 34 yards. A little right-to-left angle from the hash mark. Paquette was 2-for-2 last week, a long of 23 from 34 yards. He's got the distance on the way, and it is good. So the first quarter has ended, and it's 21-9. USF still on top, but ONU trying to get closer. We'll be back after this 30-second timeout. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio,
right,
WRDF
106.3 FM. The Midwest America Federal Credit Union football toss. Get crazy, we got cheerleaders going to throw footballs, and two of them have Coach Donnelly's autograph. If your football has an autograph of Coach Kevin Donnelly, bring it down here to redeem your prize, courtesy of Midwest America Federal Credit Union.
Our score as we get ready to start the second quarter.
We'll come back, everybody, along with Coach Donnelly, bring it right down here to the 50-yard line, and we'll get to your prize.
I guess what you would expect on first night, opening night, a lot of first-game jitters and some big positives and some big negatives.
That's exactly right, Joe. We're experiencing everything here at the home opener here at Bishop Darcy Stadium. The Cougars looking early to be on
Cougar
fire.
Fans also, let's give a round of applause for tonight's honorary captain on the sidelines with Coach Donnelly. We've got none other than Police Chief Gary Hamilton down on the field. Another round of applause for Chief Hamilton, all of our police, fire, and EMS workers here tonight. Thank you for all you do for Fort Wayne.
Early game, early season, this is what to get as conditioning starts to rev up and they get battle tested. But so far, a great contest. Tigers still showing a lot of spirit, a lot of heart, and coming back from a 21-9 or 21-0 deficit to score 9 unanswered points.
Charles Gaston back deep in kick return along with Cody Appenzeller. This time ONU will kick the ball away from left to right as we look at it.
They kept teeing it up for the
twilight descending over Darcy Stadium. What a beautiful evening, though. 82 to 83 degrees at kickoff. And here comes ONU approaching the football. And it's near side kick. Gaston looking at that one. It bounds high in the air. He's got it at the 14. Works across the field to the 15. Spins away from one tackle. Got to the 20. And up to about the 22-yard line. And here's a young man out of Bishop Lures I'm excited to see this year. He had some really brilliant returns a year ago, and I think he's in store for a great season.
Well, let's hope so, because, again, we've seen this guy play in the SAC for 4 years. Now he's out here wearing the silver and blue. He is a tremendous asset to the program. We know he's going to do well. We just need to get him some more opportunities.
Looks like this series they'll open up with Justin Green as the running back, lined up directly and behind Ferrer. First down and 10. And here's the play action fake, and Ferrer throws the home run ball. He's got Seth Cohn looking for it. Did he stay in bounds? He did. Out of bounds after he caught the... No, they're going to wave it off. Wow, the official, I thought, indicated a good catch at the 36, thought about it, and changed his mind.
That's exactly right. He was right there with the play, too. I thought for sure he got a foot in. And so did the ref of the side judge here, but he thought about it and changed his mind.
Yeah, the Cougar coach down there says, hey, he showed it was a catch, and then he changed his mind. Just like a wife, right?
Sorry, Katie. Ladies and gentlemen, you can call 436-1450.
Second down and 10. So Ferrer back to work once again. Offset to the left. They've got a running back, and there's a little bit of motion as he'll throw the ball to the right side. He's got to catch it. Boy, great hit. Setcoat came up with the ball, but hit immediately when he grabbed the ball up around the 25. Again, net gain of about 3-4 yards.
Good fundamentals by the Tigers out there in space. Nice open field tackle, limiting the gain for the Cougars.
That's one of the things that Kevin Downey told me. They went to Bourbonnais last week to see the game against Midland, and he said they were impressed. And these kids, they attack defensively, and they're quick, and they are sure tacklers. Third down and 7. Early moments of the second quarter, 21-9. USF trying to make a play, trying to get the ball up to their own 33-yard line. Ferrer drops one step, looks, loads up, throws to the right side. It's got a catch if they're inbounds. Let's see if that's a catch, and it is.
Cam Smith that time, it's impressive too, Joe, because he was in press coverage. So for him to go and do a button hook and Ferrer to have that ball right there when he needs it, that was a very well-executed play.
You know, he showed that to us, that ability to recognize where he is on the field, and you just got to get 1 foot in bounds, but you do have to have the 1 foot. And he's very, has excelled at it. So a new set of downs with the ball first and 10, and he went right to the spot where they needed to be. Ferrer again, waiting for the snap. Deep handoff. Here is Justin Green looking for running room, and he finds it as he's caught midfield and cartwheels into ONU territory down to about the 49.
You know, that's an even more impressive run because I saw the defensive front four there. They were actually slanting to the right, which was the flow of the play. So great job by the young running back that time to evade a tackle in the backfield, get around that corner, and move the chains.
You're right, Sean. The play designed to go off past the left side, but when he saw the defense converging, and it just broke it to the numbers and gained an extra 5 or 6 yards. Seth Stewart in motion. They look for him. Ferrer dances, throws it back downfield. He's got a man, but overthrew the intended receiver, Appenzeller, down inside the 5-yard line.
Appenzeller out there throwing his arms up saying, hey, can I get some love out here? He was all over me like a cheap suit. No love for Appenzeller, no flag.
Ferrer throwing that ball on a line about 55 yards. That stops the clock with 13:19 remaining here in the first half. Smith that started off the field and comes back onto the field. They want him out there. Andreas Gomez Espino threw up his hands. He thought he was going to have a chance to come into the game. Not that snap. So now second and 10. Two safeties back again. Here's Justin Green. Green looking for running room. And cuts back to the middle of the field inside the 45 to the 42. It'll be third down coming up, third down and 5.
Again, can't say it enough, Coach. When you look at the interior line play for St. Francis here, really opening up some gaping holes, giving these running backs, especially that time Justin Green, a great opportunity right through the middle.
Big call on third down coming up. 21-9 our score. The ball at the ONU 42-yard line. Montay McDowell's come back in. He split wide to the right, too wide to the left. They come up and press coverage on him. Here's Ferrer looking, dancing, can't find anything. Flush to his left, loads up, throws near side. Coat with a deflected ball, and that one close to being intercepted. They were trying to go short, as also Sean Boswell is in the vicinity of where that ball came down.
Yeah, that's exactly right. We had two receivers in the same spot right there. Boswell was one of them. He was able to get a paw on it and kind of knock the ball away. An incomplete pass, and that looks like the punt team's coming on.
Josh Spitnell will check in. Had a beautiful punt, his first and only punt of the day. And he'll wait to boom it again as high as he can, waiting at the USF 45-yard line. 12:35 remaining in this first half. Cougars got on the board with 21 quick points. But ONU scored the next 9. There's a foot, the ball, that's a wobbly ball. It'll hit and take a Cougar bounce inside the 15. Comes down to a stop outside the 10. So good job by Spitnail bottling up the Tigers. They'll go back on offense, but inside their own 15-yard line.
You know, Spitnail's leg, he knew he was going to have to try something short just like that because he can kick that monster ball, and he did a fine job kicking it off the toe, if you will, and giving it your reverse motion to it. Takes a nice hop, and it pins him back deep.
Well, we've seen Matt Ray, the young sophomore quarterback, 6'1", go all the way. Now they have a shift on. Glanders comes in, and part of a tight trips package here. Bunch of line up to the near side. Here's Ray rolling back to his left, being pursued and trying to turn the corner. Got rid of the ball late. Being pursued defensively as Cougars had him on the ropes there, being chased by Drew Durnell.
Quarterback was out of the pocket. There is no grounding.
Drew Durnell a year ago, 6 tackles, 2 for a loss. He had a sack Two quarterback hurries and a block kick. Good backup, very capable backup for USF. Now it's second down and 10. They're going to stay with that offset alignment to the right side. A play action fake. Ray wants to throw. He's at the one. Throws near side. And that one's nearly picked off. Stepping in front nicely was number 25, Darrell Holman. That might have been six.
Holman was looking at the end zone instead of looking at the ball because, again, that was, again, right in his breadbasket. He had two hands on it, and he was thinking, here comes my pick six. But you got to grab and hold on to the ball first. So, again, if he would have made that catch, that could have very well have been a pick six, but unfortunately he dropped it.
Ray was trying to get the ball to Rashawn Gaiman, but Jarrell Holman read it perfectly all the way. Now it's third and long. Two protectors in either side of Matt Ray, one of them motion, and now let's see, do we have a penalty or timeout?
Timeout.
Timeout called by Olivet Nazarene. 12:15 remaining here in this first half. We'll take a 30-second break with our score 21-9 in favor of USF. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Okay, you got an H&L, Sean, coming up.
All righty. I'll just do it now.
Yeah, sure. Right here at Darcy Stadium, 21-9, Cougars on top.
Cougar football fans, Redeemer Radio has one travel sponsor, and that's H&L Electric. Specializing in the commercial electrical needs for the business community, H&L Electric can handle the smallest to the largest of projects for your business. Call Pete Henry at 260-357-0123. That's H&L Electric at 260-357-0123.
We mentioned Olivet Nazarene, third down and 10 coming up a week ago. They did win the game, but just 4 of 18 on third downs for 22%. They need 10 yards here, trying to get out to their 21. Ray steps up in the pocket, being pursued and nailed. Boy, who came in there late for USF and just buried him right back around the 8-yard line.
Nice job of the defense that time. I didn't get a read on the sack man right there, Joe, as I was getting the first quarter stats. But, again, nice job by the defense, swarming him over, causing a tackle for loss and bringing up a fourth and long.
So now the Tigers will have to kick the ball away. And just about 2 yards away from the end line, the ONU kicker, Hale Tabler, will set up at the 44, 45-yard line of ONU. USF should come out of this with great field position. And here comes the side rugby kick, end-over-end kick. Tabler tallies it, comes back to the 40, looking to get outside, and then he had his legs taken out at the 37-yard line. But it is of the 37 of Olivet Nazarene, and USF has great field position. And they're trying to expand on this 21-9 lead here with 11:24 remaining in the first half.
Team Captain Tabler, I tell you, this guy's got some moxie right here. He has gotten plastered twice, and he gets popped up, and he actually helped an opposing player off the turf that time after he gets his legs taken out of him and pounded into the turf. So this kid's got moxie.
Cam Smith comes onto the field. He's sent wide to right. I believe Aaron Harris comes back as the running back. Got a double wing look this time. Motion out of it by Appenzeller. Play action fake, though. Ferrer wants the throw, and he's taken too long, and he's dropped again. Got back to the line of scrimmage. Blitz was coming late that time. And a good play defensively, as USF had very little time to work with. Coming in there was Michael Hovelu. I believe that was...
Yeah, I think you're right. Yeah, so again, the pass coverage breaks down and a sack here. Loss of one on the play, bringing up a second and 11. Now we've got a timeout on the field, it looks like.
Well, they're making a substitution for St. Francis. Is coming off the field is Nate Carson.
Seth Cote going back in. Yeah.
So it will be second down 11. Ferrer lost a yard on that call. Too wide to the left. They come up and press coverage again on Cam Smith. And Ferrer wants to throw. The rush is on. He evades it initially. Throws to the end zone. Got coat. Goes up high and couldn't haul it in. Got hit about the time he elevated to try to gather that ball in. It is helped up. So some good sportsmanship by the Tigers as well.
And unfortunately, Joe, I think this one wouldn't have mattered even if he would catch it. There's a flag in the backfield here. Again, some good penetrating defense that time. This one might be coming back with a hold against St. Francis.
Randy Effner is going to let us know.
Number 76 on the offense. Holding.
Another holding call against St. Francis.
Second down.
Andrew Hunt, the number they mentioned.
You know, first quarter penalties right here, Joe. St. Francis had 6 for 40 yards. Olivet had 2 for 41. And both teams, obviously St. Francis with a lot more penalties. We don't have a tally here in the second quarter, but a lot more in the first quarter.
A lot of mistakes, though. And
yeah.
Kevin Dowley will be talking to his team at halftime to clean those up. So it's second down and 21 of the ball back at the 48. Again, here's the screen pass coming up, and Harris has got it. Gets a block at the 45. Works to the 40, 35, and hit from behind. Holds on. He rolls down to about the 40-yard line. So Harris, but again, good pursuit. Again, Olivet Nazarene, their defenders beaten initially, but they don't give up on the play.
Yeah, inside linebacker Sebastian Swift, number 51, 15-pound sophomore, doing some great backside pursuit that time to bring him down. But boy, Ferrer really sold that screen. He kept backing up and drawing that front four in.
Third down in 3. Clock moves inside 10 minutes. Stretch handoff. Here's Harris off tackle. He's got a first down. Much more inside the 20. And he busted all the way down close to the 17, maybe the 16-yard line.
Just a beautiful run that time by Harris, really knowing exactly where that hole was going to be and hitting it at full speed. And another chain movement for the St. Francis Cougars.
Let's give some credit up front to Keegan Bruner along with Zach Minardo opening up the hole. So USF now, first and 10 at the 16-yard line. They'll work from the right side hash mark. And they've got a first down to work with. Coates stays in wide to the left. That's the wide side of the field. First and 10. Harris stays in as the running back. Ferrer waiting for the snap from center. Long count from the line of scrimmage. Play clock is down to 5. We're down to 4. Ferrer still has not taken the snap. Now he does. Looks to Harris. Dances to the right. Cuts back to the middle. Spins. Back pedals inside the 5. And gets close inside the 10 down to the 6-yard line.
Wow.
Too many lines down there, Sean.
That's exactly right. And you know, that offensive line got him about 4 yards. He did the rest. Close to a 10-yard gain that time.
You know, between the 5-yard line and the 10-yard line now with soccer, they've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different lines from 5 to 10 yards.
Yeah.
So second down, that's a gain of 9. And let's see if they stay with Harris as the ball carrier on second down and 1. Ferrer again, long count from line scrimmage, got motion, and wants to throw back to the right side. No, he did hand the ball off, and into the end zone. That's going to be a touchdown run. They did hand it off on the sweep, and they gave it to Sean Boswell.
Again, there's that little shovel pass. They really disguised that so well. Ferrer keeps in motion after he dumps that ball off through the middle. So in reality, it's a jet sweep without the handoff. So that little shovel pass right there to the end around, and Boswell finds the corner, goes in untouched for another St. Francis score.
So Sean Boswell gets in for 6. It'll be his first touchdown. And Ryan Nix on to try to make it a 28-9 lead for USF. Right-footed kick is on the way. Looks good and is good. So we'll step out here at Darcy Stadium. 28-9, Cougars on top. This is Cougar Football with Beamer Radio. WRCF 106.3 FM.
Austin, 1-800-TEACHERS.
Okay, got 3 more 30s before halftime, so we're good.
Do you want to go over first quarter stats?
Sure.
We have a Big Ten final.
Back at Darcy Stadium with Sean McBride. I'm Joe Parson. It's 28-9. USF has led. They scored the game's first 21 points, Sean, but now the lead is back to 19, 28-9.
That's exactly right. We can quickly go over some first quarter stats here, Joe, as the St. Francis Cougars get set to kick off as far as that goes. Total offense for ONU in the first quarter, 26 plays for 101 yards. St. Francis Cougars, 19 plays for 196 yards. And let's see, when we look at the pass attempts and completions, ONU 16-7-1, and St. Francis 10-8-0.
Rashawn Gaiman, I believe Alvin Best back deep and kick return, driving kick near side. Gaiman's got it at the goal line, comes out to the 1, to the 5, 10, 15, 20, near side, weaves his way to the 30-yard line, takes a big hit, holds on, but this is a dangerous kick return. He just glides his way.
Boy, he's strong, too. Looks like there's a flag on the play, too, Joe.
We'll see what that one is going to be about. Still have 8 minutes, 30 seconds remaining until intermission. Sean will be checking in with Coach D when the teams come out at halftime. Don't forget that St. Francis now has a marching band, and we'll see if we see their presence known here at halftime.
That is what we call some sweet action.
On the return team, number 18 on a hold. That's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the penalty. First down.
Kyle Love is the guilty Tiger, called for that penalty. That'll move the ball back to the 21-yard line. So first and 10, and I think we're going to see Zach Gross now come in to quarterback the Tigers. First time we've seen him tonight. He is the senior, was injured pretty much all year last year. Threw for 144 yards, 2 touchdowns, and no interceptions. And looking to run the ball, and he's got running room across the 30 out to the 31, 32-yard line. That was a keeper call. Zach Gross carried 22 times last week, 45 yards, and did score a couple of touchdowns, and you see why.
Yeah, he hit the hole really fast. Nice job on the fake. Well executed.
Gains 9, second and 1. Read option, second effort. And let's see, it looks like they do have the first down out to about the 32. Give was to the running back, David Payne. So the two seniors in there in the backfield now, Payne along with Zach Gross. And they throw in Chuck DeLoach, a junior, into the mix as well. So first and 10, ONU trying to counter and come back and answer the Cougar score. 28-9 our score. Motion DeLoach right to left behind the line of scrimmage. Here's a straight ahead carry by Payne and trying to find the 35-yard line. He'll gain a couple.
Not much there, but they're setting up the play action here, Joe. A lot of fake handoffs and a little misdirection back there, so they might be trying to set up something big here on a play action pass.
DeLoach stays in. He split wide to the left. Gaiman is in there wide to the right now. And here's the out of the gun and being pursued, and they've got a sack coming up, and that was Lucas Sparks that wraps up on Zach Roach. He drops him back around the 24-yard line.
Boy, a big blitz coming that time. All 7 front defenders for St. Francis just absolutely flooded that line, and a nice job by number 5-4 for the Cougars to come in and wrap him up.
Lucas Sparks had a couple of sacks last year, 229-pound junior. And it's third down and much, much longer now. Cougars making a change at the line of scrimmage defensively, and they've got to get their guys out there a little quicker. Blake Fox still with 13, 6:50 remaining in the first half. Gross out of the gun, drops the throw, looks near side. Gaiman's got it, got to watch him, and he's got running room. And he runs to the 33-yard line. It'll be 10 yards short of the first down. As in on the coverage that time, to make it was Spencer Coward that converged.
Well, again, they bring a linebacker in on the blitz package right there, and that's exactly where that short slant was hitting. So they got some positive yards. But unfortunately for Olivet, the Tigers are still facing a 4th and 9 in their own territory.
Cougars on the road in a night game next Saturday night. It will be in Upland, Indiana, game against the Trojans of Taylor University. 7 o'clock kickoff. Our pregame begins on Redeemer Radio at 6:45. Low snap. Here's a straight kick. It's high. It's short. It'll come down somewhere around midfield and out of bounds. And they may line that up into Tiger territory.
That might be about a 14-yard punt. Not much there.
Well, they got a pretty good spot. USF will take it, though. But I thought that ball was going to come back to around the 44, 45-yard
right
line. But they spotted at the 49 into Tiger territory. So here comes Nick Ferrer once again with his team on top here at home in the home opener, 28-9. New numbers coming in again for St. Francis. Now we'll see Gomez Espino in there. A little frustrated earlier when he thought he was going to get into the game. Got to bide your time, young man.
That's it.
First and 10, blitz being shown up the middle. There was whistles and now a penalty flag procedure against St. Francis.
Wow.
Or did the play clock run out?
Ball start.
Ball start.
Number 7 on the offense. Still first down.
Uh-oh.
So that'll
That was Espino, number 7.
Well, in his excitement, does something the coaches we'll chat with them about.
That's right.
That'll move the ball back to the Cougar side of midfield at the 46-yard line. First down and 15. They show second down on the scoreboard. That is incorrect. So Ferrer now on first and 15. A long count from the line of scrimmage. Four on the play clock. We're down to three and does hand the ball off. A cut back in the middle of the field, and there's some running room, and I believe that is at the Jarrell Holman.
I think it was, Joe.
So he played some defense, nearly had a pick six interception, and comes back and runs the ball. No, check it. It is 26. It's P.J. Dean. P.J. Dean into the lineup. Another one of those youngsters. And Charles Gaston is out there as well.
Yep. He's going to be in the slot right next to Espino.
That was good for 6 yards. So we're getting a little different look. Some offensive personnel in there. Ferrer, deep handoff again. And P.J. Dean diving for the first down stick inside the 40, down to about the 38.
I think he's going to have it too, Joe.
Yes, I do believe so. Connor Holcomb has come in now to snap the ball at center. Well, a warm, humid night. So they're trying to get some fresh troops in there. We're going to see Nate Carson coming onto the field. Montay McDowell checks out. And Gomez Espino stays in wide to the right side. And then another penalty flag is thrown. Procedure again against St. Francis. I think that perhaps, let's see if they mention Nate Carson. He might have been lined up offside.
Number 15 on the offense. 5 yard penalty.
A little aggressive there.
I think he just was lined up wrong because nobody moved. And again, good news, young kids getting a chance. Bad news, they're playing like they're young.
Well, that's exactly right. And typically the White House, they'll check in with the side judge and say, you know, give me a thumbs up or whatnot. And I don't know that he did.
No, you're right. They do that in high school. So this time they'll reset. It's first and 15, though. 4:40 remaining. Again, blitz shown defensively by ONU. They'll run the ball. And here's P.J. Dean running hard. And he gets the penalty yardage back and carries it down to about the 36, 37-yard line of ONU.
Yeah, nice quality gain that time. Off tackle left, finds a seam, and gets some positive yards.
Nice cuts there. And he gets the ball looking for daylight. So he'll gain seven. Got the penalty yardage back to make it second down and eight. Ferrer huddling his team up. And Gaston up in the slot to the right side. Split wide of him will be Gomez Espino. On second down, here's Ferrer, wants to keep it on the ground. And there's, no, he kept the ball himself on the read option. And he's down to the 30-yard line. You don't see Nick Ferrer often call his own number.
Yeah, that is a curious call. And I'm wondering if the back got to the hole too fast. There was some big penetration right there. I don't know if that was a broken play or design, Joe. It happened so quickly. But anyway, some great positive yards. Ferrer with good situational awareness, tucked the ball, and now they're facing a third and short.
He had 16 carries and no yards, positive yards a year ago, but a lot of that was because of sacks. 3:25 remaining. It's third down and short. They'll hand the ball off again, off tackle run. I don't think they got there as they handed it off that time to Tyrone Young. So it'll be fourth down, I believe.
Yeah, Young out of Warren Central coming in as a freshman, and unfortunately I don't think he's going to have any gain as the ball remains at the 30-yard line. But the offense is on the field.
Well, Coach D, you know, you're at the 30, you got a chance. Cloud coming alive now on fourth down and two will be the call. And Ferrer has not put the ball up recently. It's strictly a diet of runs. Got an offset eye to the left side motion by Gaston. Wants to throw this time. And now, no, he did hand. He got it to Gaston. And Gaston's got the first down close to the 25.
Again,
I didn't see him hand it off.
He did. It's that little shovel pass that they disguised the jet sweep so well. Ferrer does such a fine job of looking like he's fading to the man in motion. But no, he does a quick pitch to him. And, of course, with Gaston's speed, he was able to get to the corner in mere moments and cut it up and get a first down.
Now Cam Smith comes back in. It's first and 10 at the 25-yard line. They'll stay with that same formation. Motion by Gaston again. But Ferrer rolling to the right, being pursued. There's going to be a hold. Ferrer got rid of the ball late and a diving comeback attempt by Cam Smith. But it's going to come back one way or the other.
Yeah, and he took a shot just when he got rid of that ball. This one might be on Connor Holcomb, number 60 for the St. Francis Cougars. He's out of East Noble.
So again, a lot of holds in the first half against the Cougar Blue. And that'll back them up again.
Holding, number 60 on the offense. That's a 10-yard penalty. Remains first down.
So the ball comes back to the 35-yard line. Remains first down, but first down and 25 from the 35-yard line. Smith and Gaston break the huddle, come wide to the right side. Seth Coates out there to the near side. Two wide either side of the field. They work from the left side hash mark. And here's a short drop. The draw is coming up. Running room and to the 30 and a little checkoff move. And scrambling for running room. That was Tyrone Dunn looking again. And he gets a lot of that penalty yardage back. They'll mark him down at about the 28-yard line, Sean, and it'll bring up second down, and we'll call it 12.
Yeah, again, a nice run right there by the young recruit out of Warren Central, number 27, finding some open space out there, good situational awareness, and plowing forward for a good game.
St. Francis trying to manage the clock. We're down a minute 42 remaining. They've got all three timeouts remaining, ONU with two. It's going to be second down and actually 13. And off again, and here's Young, cuts back up the middle, fights to the 25, maybe got to the 24. So it'll be third down and 10 coming up. And USF, are they going to call a timeout? Still running down inside of a minute 20, time remaining. No sense of urgency, but no panic either.
Well, I see Cam Smith out there on the field right now. He was in on the previous play, too, wide out to the right side. I'm wondering... you know, with all the other fresh young recruits out there, Appenzeller's out there now too on the right side. Let's see what happens here on third and 10.
Including Seth Stewart, three wide to the right on third down and 10. 55 seconds remaining in the half. Short drop, throw left side. Here's reaching for it, incomplete. Seth Coates trying to grab it on his fingertips, but incomplete. So it'll be fourth down, and will they bring on Ryan Nix to attempt a field goal? Yeah, they will. Yeah. So Nix a year ago in field goals with 9 of 13. He had a long of 40 yards, but he did have two kicks blocked. See, this one will be about a 43-yard attempt. He was 1 for 1 between 40 and 49 yards, the 40-yarder. So this one would be his long in a couple of years.
Another year older, another leg stronger. Let's see what he can do here.
51.6 seconds remaining. Got the kick away. It's long enough.
Look at that.
It is good.
Oh, my.
43-yard field goal. Ryan Nix adds to the Cougar total. They'll lead it 31-9 with a timeout here at Garcia Stadium. Step out for 30 seconds. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM.
Was that Joe 43?
Yeah.
Ryan Nix teeing it up once again for the Cougars.
Well, Ryan Nix, I believe that's his career best for the St. Francis Cougars as he hits from 43 yards out, and now USF takes their biggest lead of the night at 22 points.
Zach Gross.
And they'll kick it away from right to left. Well, the twilight still a little bit present here at Darcy Stadium. And Rashawn Gaiman is back in the kick return. So Cougars getting ready to kick the ball away. 46.2 seconds remaining. Here's a low line drive kick that'll filter through to the 8-yard line. Gaiman's got it out quickly to the 20. Looks to his left, wrapped up and dropped. Short of the 25. And Gaston was down there quickly. And wraps them up, so it'll be first and 10 for ONU at their own 22-yard line.
Not a lot of time left for Olivet Nazarene here. 35 seconds remaining in the first half.
Looks like they're going to bring Matt Rate back in at quarterback.
Tigers are taking over first and 10 on their own 24.
See where they do spot that ball. Boy, that's a really good spot of the ball. Gave them +2 on that, I thought. And they do mark it up around the 24-yard line.
Reset the clock to 38 seconds. That's 3-8.
Put some time back on the clock.
Time and yardage, Joe. What a deal.
ONU feels like they're home.
That's right.
Cougar coaches were watching the game last week, and they were kind of shaking their heads on a couple of calls that went the home way, shall we say. High snap, but they'll hand the ball off, running play up the middle. And there's some running room out close to a first down, out to at least the 34-yard line.
Nice job by the Olivet running back, Michael Holewis, 5'11", 199 senior, being very patient in the backfield and then finding his hole.
They run again, and here's Holewis out to the left side. A week ago, Sean, he threw the ball, actually, on a halfback option and threw a 69-yard touchdown pass. Got to be aware of that with 18 seconds remaining. No huddle offense, hurry up look, and they'll hand it off to Ho again. Here he comes, high ho, as he tries to fight for the first down, but knocked down at the 43, and that may do it. Not sure they're going to get, though. They do take a timeout. They had two remaining, and they'll take one right here.
That's for second and a half.
With 7.2 seconds remaining, and we'll keep things right here at Darcy Stadium. 31-9 our score.
That might be exactly what they're setting up here for, Joe. You know, they're going to maybe take a shot downfield here at the winning seconds of the first half, and Holewis might be the guy. You know, again, with that halfback pass, they were successful with it before. They've given it the ball, given him the ball on these first two downs. So they might try it again here.
And I believe it was Gaiman that caught that touchdown on the halfback option last week. So, again, awfully, and I'm sure the Cougar coaches are aware of that. I know Coach D was there at the game. So I'll spot the ball at the ONU 43-yard line. It'll be third down and a yard, but really academic because just 7.2 seconds remains in the half. Cougars already dropping four back into deep coverage, including Jalen McIntyre. Joel Holman's back there as well. So they're back around the USF 45-yard line. Two linebackers and four deep safeties, as you will. Two safeties and the corners. So Ray, looking to make a play right here, drops the throw, screens the ball near side. It will be a run, and that they'll get the first down. That may leave time for one more play if they can get up to the line of scrimmage. The clock shows 1.8 seconds remaining.
Pass thrown to number 16, Matt McKinney.
Kind of an interesting call, but they did get the first down.
No, I don't think so, Joe. I think that was actually an incompletion.
Oh, they ruled it incomplete.
Yeah.
Clock did stop, so it'll be fourth down, and they can run a play, obviously, with 1.8 seconds remaining. And there was movement.
Uh-oh.
Well, everybody moved both sides of the ball, but let's see, there were two blue-shirted Cougars, but this one I think is going to go against ONU.
Clock start. Number 69 on the offense. Still second down.
So that'll move the ball back inside the 40 to the 38. So it's fourth down and six. Gaiman is lined up here to the near side, and USF, they're about 20 yards away from the line of scrimmage, that deep four. And Holewis looking to run the ball, sweeping left side, and he'll get back across the 40 to the 42. But that will do it here in the first half. So a lead of 22 for the homestanding Cougars on the opener here at Darcy Stadium under the lights. Open the college football 2015 season. And a lot of things to be happy about, a lot of positives, and certainly some things to clean up. And the coaching staff will be talking about the mistakes as well as the positives. 31-9 here at halftime. We'll take a one-minute timeout, and we'll be back with our halftime presentation. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Okay, 2:30s.
Do I have a live read?
Coming out of the 1 minute, yeah. We may have to turn that light on, Sean.
Yeah, no worries.
At least for halftime.
Oh, I like the light. The reflections don't bother me. I know a lot of guys, the windows get a little sideways, but I can see through it. So
the
problem is what I can't see down here. So
Wells Fargo Insurance Services, Ice Game.
Is that okay for you?
Right now it is. Yeah. Maybe at the start, we'll see.
Provider of USF Athletics and Midwest America Federal Credit Union. Presenting sponsor for today's game.
Bank of Darcy Stadium under the lights here in this home opener with Sean McBride, Joe Parson with you. And some ups, some downs for USF in the first half. And I think we could assess safely and say more ups than downs in that first half.
Yeah, I would certainly agree, Joe. Obviously, the St. Francis Cougars came out strong with 21 points here in the first quarter, leading 21-9 after the first quarter. Round two, the second quarter, still give it to the Cougars. They held Olivet Nazarene to 0 points and added to their lead 31-9 here at halftime. So with all the mistakes that were out there and all the clean jerseys, you know, the young guys getting in and making a couple of mistakes, still hats off to the Cougars offense and the defensive squads.
Yeah, it'll be interesting when we get the official numbers from Bill Scott here, yep. The first half numbers. And there were a lot of penalties, both sides of the ball. But again, you can't take anything away. 31 first half points, and I know Coach Donnelly just got to be thrilled about that. Line score in the ball game, St. Francis, you mentioned, Sean, 21 quick points to lead to 21-0. But then ONU answered with 9 straight of their own to make it 21-9 at the end of the opening quarter. But all USF in the second quarter when they scored the game's only 10 points. All started, and it started quickly. After the kickoff, to the 20-yard line. It was a one-play, 80-yard touchdown pass from Ferrer to Cam Smith. Good to the house at the 14:42 mark. Fans still filing into the stadium, and 7-0 USF after Knicks added the extra point. Then we had some exchanges, a punt return fumble by USF, but the Cougar defense held them on downs. The first of 3 fourth down stops, I believe, they had in the first half, 2 of them at least. 2 fourth down stops, but then they fumbled the ball away and got it back. They recovered at their own 43-yard line. That would set up a little pitch to Appenzeller. Ruled a pass completion on the little shovel pass. Good for 13 yards at the 10-12 mark. Make it 14-0 USF. Then after the second fourth down stop, USF would take just one play. They took over the ball on their own at the Olivet Nazarene 47-yard line. And Ferrer found Monty McDowell at the goal line. He reached out, got possession of the ball, reached across the plane of the goal. 21-0 USF, the first 21 points of the ball game going to the Cougar Blue. But Ray would come back. Matt Ray, the young sophomore, 6'1 quarterback for Olivet Nazarene. And he hooked up with Rashawn Gaiman for a 46-yard touchdown at the 6:53 mark. The kick was blocked for the extra point. It would be 21-6 in favor of USF. And then Cale Tabler took over on an interception at the St. Francis 14-yard line, but they fumbled it back. Ferrer got hit from the blind side, coughed it up at the 12. That set up a 33-yard field goal that was good by Nick Paquette. And that would be a 21-9 ball game at the end of that first quarter. Cougars with all the points, 10 points in the second quarter. Ferrer with a shovel pass to Sean Boswell at the 8:36 mark, good for 7 yards and a touchdown. Knicks hit the extra point to make it 28-9. And then how about Ryan Knicks? Coming through big, he had a long field goal of 40 yards a year ago, came back and hit a 43-yard field goal with 46 seconds and change on the clock. 31-9, that's where we are at the half. And again, a lot of positives for St. Francis fans and the coaches to build upon.
I agree, Joe. Again, it'd be very interesting. I'm certainly going to ask Coach what his message was to the team in the first half. Obviously, we want to limit mistakes because they've had too many penalties as far as that goes. But on that positive note, that Cougar defense did not give any opportunity to Olivet to score points off turnovers. That's a big thing. That is a key to victory throughout the game of football. You cannot let the other team score off of your mistakes, and that's exactly what the Cougar defense did not allow.
31-9 our score here at halftime. We're in a break, and I tell you what, let's step out for this 60-second message. And we'll be back with more of our halftime presentation. This is Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio, WRDF, 106.3 FM. Those halftime numbers?
Yep.
Oh, good.
Okay. We got them.
We'll turn you loose. By the way, you've got a Notre Dame live read.
Okay.
In the mix there.
You want that first? Or
your choice.
Okay.
Then we'll also have a Todd Briscoe live read at halftime. Yes, sir. Gotcha. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. Back at Darcy Stadium, we're at halftime, and it's a 31-9 St. Francis lead over visiting Olivet Nazarene University. Sean McBride's with us as well here at halftime, and he's got a look at the halftime numbers.
Let's run it down, Joe. For the St. Francis Cougars, we're talking about first downs, doubling up over Olivet Nazarene, 14-7. So 14 first downs right there for your Cougars. Rushes, we've got 21 rushes for 120 yards on the ground for St. Francis. Passes, we've got 202 yards through the air. And, of course, Ferrer going 13 of 19 with no interceptions. So total offense for your St. Francis Cougars, 40 plays, 322 total offensive yards in the first half. On the other side of the ball, offensively for the Tigers, they have 7 first downs. They have 19 rushes for 41 yards and 92 yards through the air. Their quarterback going 8 for 20 with 1 pick. So offensively, 39 plays, 133 total offensive yards. No fumbles on the day with yardage right there. Punt returns for yards, 3 punt returns for 47 yards for St. Francis. And, of course, for Olivet, punt returns, they had 1 punt return for 0 net yards. Kickoff returns. Now, this is an important one. 5 kickoff returns for Olivet Nazarene, 153 yards there. Only 3 kickoff returns for St. Francis for 43 yards. Interceptions. 1 interception, St. Francis, 3 yards return there. Punts, 4 punts for Olivet with 31 yards there. 2 punts for St. Francis for 39 yards. Let's look at these penalties here, Joe, because it's important. 4 penalties for Olivet Nazarene for 59 yards. 10 penalties for your St. Francis Cougars, totaling 70 yards. Possession time goes in the sway of the Cougars, 18 minutes and 4 seconds compared to 11 minutes and 51 seconds. Third down conversions, both teams kind of equal. 2 conversions for the Tigers, 2 of 9 there, and 2 of 8 for St. Francis. So both teams converting twice on third downs. Fourth down conversions, the Cougars converted 1 out of 2 and 0 out of 2 for Olivet. Red zone scores and chances, 1 out of 1 for the Tigers, and the St. Francis Cougars perfect at 2 and 2 for red zone scores and chances. So there is the tail of the tape right there. Let's go through some individual stats for your St. Francis Cougars. Aaron Harris has 7 rushes on the night with 75 yards. Justin Green has 3 rushes for 24 yards. P.J. Dean has 3 rushes for 22 yards. And Tyrone Young, 3 rushes for 10 yards. Again, your averages right there. Aaron Harris averaging 10.7 yards per carry, and Justin Green averaging 8 yards per carry there. Through the air, we have Nick Ferrer, 11 of 16 right there for 212 yards. The longest, again, to Cam Smith officially, marking it as a 79-yard pass, and he's been sacked 3 times. Cale Tabler, 2 for 3 right there, minus 10 right there. Your receivers, Cam Smith on top, 5 catches for 119 yards with a touchdown, the long of 79 yards there. Montay McDowell making his presence known, 2 catches for 40 yards right there, the longest of 47. Aaron Harris with a catch for 18 yards, and Cody Appenzeller with a catch for 13. Josh Spitnell, the standout from Snyder, 2 punts on the night, 78 yards, averaging 39 yards with a long of 47, and that one landed inside the 20. Punt returns right here. Cale Tabler has 2 punt returns for 48 yards. Cody Appenzeller with a negative 1 right there. Appenzeller for a kick return, actually 2 of them for 33 yards. And Charles Gaston, number 1, has a 10-yard kick return right there. On the other side of the ball, your tackle leaders, Pearson Harnish right here has a total of 9, Lucas Sparks with 5, Jackson with 3, and Matt Muncy with 3 as well. So that's the tale of the tape for the University of St. Francis Cougars, and everything lopsided their way so far, Joe. Unfortunately, what's also lopsided is the penalties.
Kind of jumps out, you mentioned Lucas Sparks having 5 tackles, 1 sack, also 1.5 tackles for loss. And the one intriguing thing, and I question this a little bit, I don't remember Cale Tabler out there throwing a pass.
Well, I don't either. That's going to be interesting how that one actually made it on there.
Two for 3, though. Looked good, doesn't it?
Yeah, unfortunately, negative 10 yards. So we'll have to get some clarification from Bill on that one. But, yeah, all in all, very high-performing team right here so far, the St. Francis Cougars, but they need to limit the mistakes.
Boy, how about total yardage? You talked about it earlier. 322 first-half total yards production for St. Francis. They held ONU to 133 yards. Those are numbers that will win you some games.
Well, that's exactly right. And again, we talked about it. They blanked them in the second quarter. Again, they had nine first-quarter points. And so St. Francis Cougars pitching a shutout here in the second quarter going into the halftime. So, folks, you can help support your Catholic parish or school and help yourself in the process with Notre Dame Federal Credit Union's Elevate program. Call Elevate at 844-230-6611 or visit them online at edneelevate.com to learn more.
We are at halftime. We're waiting for the specialist to come out, and we're going to take a one-minute timeout. And we'll be back with more of our halftime presentation. I know you're going down, and it'll be interesting to see Kevin Downey's assessment of the first half. And if he's like a lot of coaches, he'll tell you a lot about the negatives.
That's right.
We'll find out, though. It's 31-9 St. Francis in the halftime lead over visiting Olivet Nazarene University. And we'll be back after 1 minute. This is Cougar Football at home here at Darcy Stadium on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Yes, sir. 2:30s, we'll have 1:30 then before halftime, or before the start of the second half. Okay. I'll stand up so I can see you. I'll stand up so I can see you. Robert, I'll give you that final 30 after Kevin's interview. You're back at Darcy Stadium, about 6.5 minutes until the start of the second half. 31-9 USF. They scored the game's first 21 points. Got a report in that Notre Dame-Texas game, 14-0 Irish, with about 11 minutes remaining in the first half in that one. So the Irish off to a good start. And so is Nick Ferrer. He was 11 of 16 unofficially. We may have a correction on that in the final box, but what we are being told and shown, 11 of 16 for 212 yards, including four touchdowns and no interceptions. So a very big positive, very big plus for St. Francis. And I wanted to see if we had any further information on that. Not finding what I'm looking for right now. Other games going on elsewhere today. Earlier in the Mid-States Football Association, St. Ambrose wins over Concordia, but a little tougher game than a lot of people might have thought, with the Fighting Bees winning it 25-21. Seattle Heights was up big when he found a star earlier in the game, or earlier in the day, I should say, playing at Lindenwood Belleville. We'll be there on September the 26th. And a night game, Taylor taking on Anderson. Marion and Missouri Baptist were idle today. And we mentioned Taylor will be there at the home of the Trojans next Saturday night. Again, it'll be a 7 o'clock kickoff. Our pregame on Redeemer Radio will begin at 6:45 p.m. Well, the Cougars came in to today's ball game and through the preseason missing several key performers, but they've been able to find adjustments and find some new folks to step in and pick up the slack. But Keith Kelsall went out with an injury, at 39 catches and four touchdown catches a year ago. Matt Knoll was out with a knee injury, three touchdowns a year ago. And another costly loss, running back Jason Nicodemus, with 71 yards and a touchdown catch a year ago. And we were talking to Pat Donnelly last week, and he said that the really frustrating part about those injuries, none of them came during any kind of real competition. They were during drills, or they just stepped wrong. We'll be going down here shortly to check in with John McBride, waiting for the team and Coach D to come out. As soon as you're ready, John can take it away. some of the team specialists coming out right now.
Got him right here, Joe. Coach Donnelly, impressive first half so far. What was your message to the team during halftime?
We've got another 30 minutes. We start this half 0-0. These guys have a pledge to one another. It's 100% maximum effort, 60 minutes each and every Saturday, everything you got. We're starting over again.
Very good. Thanks very much, Coach. Back up to you, Joe.
John McBride with the coach and getting to the point as he has a knack of doing. 30 minutes still remaining in a football game and a lot can turn around. Remember, Olivet Nazarene won the toss, so they will get the ball. They deferred. They'll get the ball to start here in the second half. They trail by 22 points on the road. And it's 31-9. We're going to step out for 30-second timeout, and we'll be back with the second half kickoff. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Looking ahead, the next home game, and by the way, it'll be homecoming. It'll be 2 weeks from today. It'll be a 12 noon kickoff. And USF will take on the Trinity International Trojans. So for the next 2 weeks, they play a team nicknamed the Trojans. 12 noon, the kickoff here at Darcy Stadium. We mentioned that kind of culminates a great week of homecoming festivities. So check the USF website at sf.edu for all the neat things going on week after next. But USF against Trinity International 2 weeks from today, 11:45, our pregame begins on Redeemer Radio. And again, next Saturday night, we'll be in Upland to bring you the game between St. Francis and the Tri-State Trojans, Taylor University Trojans. Boy, that came from left field. Teams coming out here now getting ready with their final warm-ups. Yeah, looking at some of the numbers from a year ago, the Tigers averaged just 14 points a ball game. They gave up 27. St. Francis at times struggled. They scored some points, averaged over 29 points a ball game in season 2014, but also gave up 23.4. Their strength was the passing game. It's been a strength so far here tonight. They averaged over 240 yards through the air a season ago, but they also gave up 189 yards a game through the air. Last week, ONU, they passed for 150 yards, but also gave up 203, and to some extent, USF's been able to exploit that, Sean McBride, here in the first half.
Well, they surely have, and it's interesting you talk about the numbers and what's happening on the field. I got an update from Bill Scott while I was out there, and turns out the passing from Cale Tabler has been removed from the passing column. So, again, Nick Ferrer going 11 for 16 for 212 yards here in the first half. So,
hey, it's opening night.
It is. That's right. We're making mistakes everywhere. It's no problem. So,
all's well that ends well, hopefully. Right now, 31-9.
Well, folks, if you can hear this game, it's thanks to our communication sponsor, Dr. Todd and Mary Briscoe and Briscoe Family Dentistry. Their generous financial support helps make this Redeemer Radio Sports broadcast possible. If you need emergency dental care, call Dr. Briscoe at 260-486-9950.
Well, Matt Ray's warming up at quarterback for the Tigers here. He played most of the way in the first half. Completed 8 of 20 passes for 92 yards, had one touchdown, was sacked one time, and also suffered one interception. But that is a building block for that young sophomore. A week ago, he started and was just 2 of 6 through the air for 7 yards and was picked off 3 times. Zach Grossup went most of the way, ran for 22 times for 45 yards, scored a couple of touchdowns, and was 6 of 19 through the air. No touchdowns. It was intercepted one time. USF will kick it away from right to left. Gaiman back deep in the kick return once again. And he had some impressive Kick returns, five kick returns in the first half, and a total of 53 yards, and that averages out 30 yards a kick return. So Nick's waiting for the go-ahead. 31-9 our score. Here's the kick, high, end over end. That comes far side at the 5. Return across the 10 to the 15. Across the 20-yard line, cut it up to about the 25-yard line. So that one was Deloach on the kick return. He came in last week. He had one kickoff return for 15 yards. And first and 10 now for the Tigers.
Well, it'll be interesting to find out what they talked about at halftime there, Joe, because, again, this defense for St. Francis has been exceedingly stout, and they've been able to sniff out a lot of things here and really limit the offense here for the Tigers. So let's think they have a new game plan.
See if they open up with David Payne as the running back here, though. Ray wants to screen the ball. He's got the catch made, and that's Glander spins off a tackle, trying to fight his way up to the 50-yard, to the 30-yard line, I should say, across the way. Cougars converge on him. That'll be playing good for about 5 yards.
Yeah, right? Quick little screen out there to the left side, very low percentage, so it was good.
And again, the Cougars caught.
Oh, they did.
And the quick play, and they're in trouble, as the game will be into Cougar territory inside the 40-yard line.
Wow.
I don't see a penalty flag. The Cougars had too many men on the field with a late substitution again. That would be about the third time tonight that's happened.
There is one down here by Coach D near the 40-yard line, Joe.
But I believe that's going to be against USF and declined by the Tigers, as they're in business with a quick-hitting play, and St. Francis has been very slow defensively in getting personnel in to the field of play.
Illegal substitution on the defense, number 8. That's declined. The result of play, first down.
They'll have it first and 10 at the USF.
Tigers on the ball, first and 10.
We've got to check that spot because it's up around the 38-yard line, first and 10.
31 yards on the play.
And Ray has a great opportunity trying to draw ONU close. They'll hand the ball off and a cut to the right side. And boy, nothing there. USF played that very well, knifing in. I believe that was Lucas Sparks.
Well, it's impressive, too, because the left guard pulled to be a lead blocker on that play, and the stun it to the correct side, the defense did, and just shut it right down.
Tell you what, Carrington Thompson came away from his right defensive end and converged on that play also. Here's the screen. Rashawn Gaiman has slowed up, but he gets away from one, gives ground, and falls down back outside the 40 to 42. Cougars had the numbers that time, and they just stayed with that talented player.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Finally able to wrap him up on defense was number 9, Pearson Harnish.
Pearson Harnish, the talented freshman out of Norwell High School, and Kevin Daly says he's the real deal.
Yes.
Third down and 12. Ray to the air. Steps up, looking. Now being hit, and there's a ball intercepted. That's got a chance to go the other way at the 40 to the 30-yard line. And the interception will take the ball into Tiger territory. Spencer Coward on the pick.
You know, and that was caused by the defensive front. Just as he was releasing that ball, he got hit in the back, and the ball fell forward right into the defender's hand. So Spencer doing a nice job playing heads up, and a nice job by the Cougar defense.
That'll take that ball to the 28-yard line of ONU. And that's the second pick of the night for the Cougar defense. And they've got an ONU player down, also back around the St. Francis 40-yard line. So we have a stoppage of play right now with 13:17 remaining in this third quarter. Still 31-9, but USF will have the ball at the 26 of the Tigers when we return after this 30-second timeout. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM.
If he's still down, I can plug Friday night if you want.
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a knee. Yeah. Don't think it's a lineman. Still working on the injured. And that may be Matt Ray that's down.
I think it is. Number 2?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that would be a tough injury for the Tigers right there. Not that anyone isn't, but that's their starting quarterback.
Sean, you got a big Friday night.
Yeah, big Friday
up.
Night coming up, Joe, in the SAC. Absolutely right. Coming off two huge victories are the Bishop Dwinger Saints and the Northside Redskins. as both teams have knocked off the two newcomers to the SAC. Of course, Bishop Dwyer with a victory, a big one over Homestead, and a come-from-behind win for the Northside Redskins over Carroll. So we're going to check out next week the Bishop Dwyer Saints versus the Northside Redskins right here on Redeemer Radio. Tailgate talk starts at 6 p.m. on Friday night, followed immediately by game coverage from Chambers Field.
So Matt Ray, the 6'1 sophomore quarterback, being assisted off the field. He's on his feet, but he's got some help. And that means probably we're going to see Zach Gross the rest of the way for the Tigers offense. But now USF will work offensively. Gus Hancock leads them out at one of the guard positions. Also Alex Wood in there. And it'll be first and 10 from the 26. Ferrer out of the pistol alignment again, looking and wants to throw. Play action fake, throws the left side. Got a man open in the left corner, but missed him. That was Appenzeller working to the left corner of the end zone. But Ferrer, he's had some muscle tonight. Missed a couple of open.
That's exactly right. Again, if that had some more loft on it and a little more time for Appenzeller to get underneath that ball, that could have been a touchdown. But a little too many Wheaties flakes this morning for Ferrer.
322 offensive yards totally for St. Francis in the first half. Ferrer was 11 of 16, 212 through the air, four touchdowns, no interceptions. Second and 10 now. Ball at the right side hash mark. Three wide to the left. Stretch handoff. Here's Harris, running room. Works and fell down. He tripped over the 20-yard line. Tried to make a little cut. Did you get the feeling it was slicking off, though? We had rain earlier today.
It kind of looked like it. When I was out there, Joe, it was draining very well. He might have just lost his footing that way. But hats off to Alex Wood, left tackle for the St. Francis Cougars. Did a phenomenal job of sealing that edge and giving him some room to run out there.
As it is a gain of six, so it'll be third down. They'll call it a short four. Clock will approach 12 and a half minutes, time remaining in this third quarter. No score either way so far, 31-9 at halftime. Movement a little bit at the line of scrimmage. Now the sweep and the second back through and a cut to the left side. That's Harris, and he will score. Aaron Harris with the second back through the hole. It'll take it from 20 yards out at the 12-25 mark. A nice little new look offensively on that running play.
A thing of beauty, a little ISO on the left side, and he found the hole and went right through. The interesting thing about it, they lined up heavy right when Alex Wood, the left tackle, lined up on the far right side. I wondered if they were going to flow to the right, but they ISO'd the left, and it paid off. Wow.
Cougars make the Spencer Cowherd touch, the interception pay off. And now Ryan Nix will come on to try to make it a 38-9 ball game. Nix hit a 43-yarder field goal just before halftime and booms this one on its way through the uprights. So 38-9 with a stop at your Darcy Stadium. We'll be back in 30 seconds. This is Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio on WRDF 106.3 FM. You'll have an H&L at your convenience.
Okay, do. Let me get this tweet out here.
Cougars build it out to a big lead of the night of 29 points now, and they'll kick it away from right to left.
Charles DeLoach deep for the Tigers.
DeLoach back deep and kick return, and Rayshon Gaiman once again.
Ryan Nix teeing up the Cougars.
Well, folks, as we prepare for this kickoff, just a reminder that Redeemer Radio has one travel sponsor, and that's H&L Electric, specializing in commercial electrical needs for the business community. H&L Electric can handle the smallest to the largest of projects for your business. Call Pete Henry at 260-357-0123.
DeLoach takes it at the two, works left side across the 15 quickly and tripped up and got to the 20-yard line. Cougar pursuit down there in a hurry once again, making the plays. That's been a story. They've had pretty good special teams play tonight. I believe that was Travon Wilson.
You know, that's exactly what I was going to say, Joe. One of the things we've really lacked to talk about is the great special teams play out of St. Francis tonight. They really haven't given Olivet great field position. They've been down in coverage and held them in check.
You know, we were doing the Concordia game last season, and Wilson had an interception returned for 66 yards, and my roster had blown away. I didn't know who it was, and none of the teammates on the sidelines said they had a nickname for him. I believe it was Skinny. And I said, well, who's Skinny? They had no clue. We found out later it was Trevon Wilson.
Carrington Thompson that time doing a fantastic job on the DN side of that time. Started to go outside, got rid of his blocker, and made the tackle for a short gain.
Gain of a couple, second down and eight. Landers with motion right to left behind the line of scrimmage. Now they offset the running back to the right side, and as we mentioned, it will be Zach Gross in there at quarterback, and they'll run the ball. That'll be a gain out across the 20, but short of the 25.
Zach Gross on the
knows the football will be just inside the 25-yard line. They'll bring up still third down and about six.
Yeah, Gross on the read option there decides to tuck it and run. Doesn't find much, but still sets him up with a third manageable.
Got to get out to the 30-yard line. Third down and five. Low snap, and they'll hand the ball. No, it's a pass, and that one is nearly picked off. In and out of the hands, trying to get that ball to Matt Muncy. And that would have been a big lift for that young youngster. Had eight tackles last year, 255-pound sophomore.
Out of Lafayette, Indiana, McCutcheon High School there. He's doing a fine job for the Cougars tonight. A little finer would have been an interception right there.
So the Tigers go three and out. They'll have to kick the ball away. And USF, let's see if they still have Taylor back in there. You know, Keel, it's been a interesting night. He had an interception. He also got nailed on a punt return, fumbled it away. Nice spiral ball, and Taylor calls for a catch. And the right decision that right
good
back, Sean.
Good call, absolutely. He had a couple of white jerseys right around him, and I think he's tired of getting plastered. So good call that time by Taylor, the team captain.
Well, with the Cougars up here at home by 29 points now, their big lead of the night. Let's see if we saw some newer numbers coming in, but we'll see Cam Smith coming out again on this series. Appenzeller's out there. Ferrer comes back out to engineer the offense. We will see Justin Green as the running back. He lines up in the one back position. They've got a wing back on the right side. They'll hand off to Justin Green. Running room off to the right as he rolls out across the 40 all the way to the 45-yard line.
The Tigers are going to have to do something about that interior. Maybe look at a five-man front or something, because St. Francis seems to be running at will and getting at least 5 yards through the middle whenever they want it.
Doing a nice job, that offensive line here tonight by and large. They've got Zach Gegner in now. And he's part of a trips package, wide to the right side on second and short. Blitz being shown just momentarily. Ferrer wants to throw. The rush is on. And got rid of the ball. That one had trouble all the way at the snap of the ball.
Yeah, they were coming from an outside blitz. The linebackers got in there. It looked to be a screen initially to begin with, as the tailback, number 17, Justin Green, did a little three-yard turnaround. But again, he was under so much pressure that Ferrer just had to bury the ball.
Caleb Cole was in there applying the pressure as well. So now it's third down and one. Green stays in as the running back. They'll hand the ball to him. Cuts to his right. Dances up the middle. He's midfield. He's at the 45. Inside the 35 to the 30 in a foot race. Down inside the 20 to the 15. He accelerates in a touchdown.
Wow.
What a move. He went to that second gear. And that is a touchdown run of some 55 yards for the youngster, the redshirt freshman, Justin Green.
Unbelievable. Showed patience when he needed to, waited for the block. When he found that those green anchors out there, he switched into second gear. That kid has some wheels, and he scored six. Wow. Great run.
Counted at the 10-24 mark. He was just like lulling to sleep a little bit. In fact, he had blockers in front that he decided, I've got to go the rest of the way myself inside the 20. So a great touchdown run
for the redshirt freshman. Wow. I'll
tell you what, you know, the Cougars have been blessed with some great. Now they're going to try for two, apparently. So here's Ferrer, hands it to Green again. Oh, did they roll him out of bounds? I think they did.
Oh.
Green on the carry.
I think you're right.
So no touchdown. Take away the 55-yard. We've got it marked up already. So it's first and goal. And they mark that ball now, no second down and goal. No gain. It's at the 7-yard line. Did not see the official indicate out of bounds. But they'll have to do it again.
Well, tremendous run regardless for the redshirt freshman there. And they're going to try and keep him in there and maybe give him another shot at the end zone here.
Wing back up on the right, the left side, I should say. Motion right to left behind the line of scrimmage. A lot of misdirection. Ferrer has to get rid of it and throw it away. And hit after he threw the ball away. Cougar crowd was maybe thinking roughing the passer, but they're not going to get that call.
Well, there was a flag that came out in the backfield down there, Joe. Now, Seth Cote was coming out from his end position, going in a flaring out to the flats on the right side. He was the intended receiver, and he went down in a big shot. Let's see what the call is.
Defensive pass interference, number 51.
Yep.
Would be a spot foul. Automatic first down.
Sebastian Swift is called for the penalty. DePatis, by the way, Sean, was the defender applying a pressure, knocking down Ferrer after he got rid of that ball. But that one did not stand up. It'll be first and goal at the 5.
Yeah, I think as Seth was dragging across the field, the inside linebacker gave him a shot, and that was the penalty.
Seth Stewart up on the wing to the left side. The running back is Justin Green. They'll give the ball to him. Cuts back to his left. Upended. Cartwheeled down inside the 5 to about the 3-yard line.
Stop made by number 20, Drew Filson.
Safety came up that time. Had 4 tackles last week. Drew Filson on the stop. So it'll be second and goal right at the 3-yard line.
One, second and goal from the 4.
Looks like we might have a timeout on the play here first. As the Tiger is making his way off the field, might be an equipment issue there, Joe.
Yeah, I think the officials, they've not marked the ball ready for play. Still 25 on the play clock. And now it does run. So St. Francis, plenty of time to come up to the line of scrimmage. Well, now they're going to wind the clock down for 40 seconds. Same formation with Green offset to the left, the running back. Ferrer out of the pistol, ready to take the snap. A little bit of flinch movement on the left side offensively. Here's short drop. No, they hand the ball off again. And into the end zone, second effort for the touchdown. So Appenzeller got that again. But I tell you what, Ferrer is really selling that handoff of that pass.
That is at least 3 or 4 times that they got me on that one, too, Joe. They just sweep from right to left. Appenzeller that time got the little shovel pass. Ferrer is just brilliant at disguising that thing. And fooling everybody, especially the defense, which is most important.
It's like he's almost letting the play go by him and then, you know, handing or passing that ball off with a shovel pass. Nick's on to attempt the extra point, looking to make it 45, and everybody moving at the line of scrimmage, so they'll sort that out.
You know, Joe, in basketball, they have a term for that, the touch pass, if you will. So as soon as the ball comes to you, you flex your fingers and you move it along. That's exactly what Ferrer is doing. The timing on that is impeccable because everyone that's come across that line, Ferrer has just been able to do a touch pass.
Number 94. On defense, at the distance to the goal, replay the try.
That one goes against the Tigers. Ryan Smith called for encroaching. That'll shorten the distance slightly for Ryan Nix. Well, he's done everything the Cougars have asked tonight. Hit the 43-yard field goal just before halftime. Now the right-footed extra point attempt on the way, and that is good. So it's 45-9, and St. Francis Gonna, I think, turn some heads. You know, that struggle 6-5 a year ago. Yes, they made the late run, winning 4 straight before the loss of Marion. But anytime you can, open up after a struggling year and already 45 points with still 8:40 remaining here in the third quarter, that is going to get some people's attention.
Well, and that's exactly right. One of the things we cannot do is let everyone think that all of it, the Tigers are a slouch team. They clearly are not. This is a very well-coached and fundamentally sound team here. But really, St. Francis is just pulling away with this one. Ryan, this high-powered offense is something to talk about. But for me, they're pitching a shutout after the first quarter. 9 points still on the board for Olivet. So the defense really has done yeoman's work here tonight. Both sides of the ball for St. Francis really firing on all cylinders.
My only disappointment, Justin Green. I thought he deserved that longest 60-yard touchdown run. 55 yards, I guess.
Well, there's still time on the clock. Maybe he can pull one out. Let's see what happens.
Going to have to get the ball back. And here's Rashawn Green and Deloach. They're shifting now. Return positions. Gaiman has been on the right side, but he switches off to the left as he called his teammate over. Here comes Nix. Let's see if he caught that. He's going to give it to Gaiman. Runs up. It'll be a shorter kick at the 11. Gaiman left sidelines, looking for running room, and runs into a wall at about the 25. He'll get another couple of yards out to about the 27-yard line. First and 10 for the Tigers. And again, we will look to see senior quarterback Zach Gross in there, the reputed running quarterback, as Matt Ray was injured earlier in this third quarter. Looked like his night was done.
Yeah.
Well, I know that Brian Fish was so disappointed a year ago with so many injuries to David Payne, among others, and Zach Gross. And to see Ray go down, Tigers trying to keep the ball on the ground, but they're only going to pick Michael up about a yard and a half up to about the 28-yard line.
Again, we talked about the differences, Joe, between last year and this year. One of the things I really see, Ferrer has much more composure this year, a lot more experience under his belt, and he's managing this game very well.
Holman's got the coverage defensively for St. Francis near side. Here's motion, but they want to run the ball. Counter run coming back to the left, but Cougars defensively right side stayed there at home. Gain will be out across the 30 to the 31-yard line. It'll bring up third down. Third down and still
number
about seven.
Is out for one play. The helmet came off.
One of the Tigers apparently lost his headgear, and he will be out for at least a play. I think that was Eric Anderson was in there. Now motion back to the left side by Ho Lewis. Sets up on the wing, and as Gross throws that way, but nowhere near. He threw it wide, and he looks uncomfortable throwing the ball.
Yeah, very much so. Very stiff back there in the pocket. I don't know really what the issue is there, but no comfort there whatsoever by the Tigers on offense.
Now, Sean, you remember back in the pregame we were watching, they had a couple of different quarterbacks that warming up, and they had one that caught our eye. He was about 6'6".
Yeah, that's exactly right. I think that was number 14, was it not, Joe? That was, Derek Dirks?
Correct.
Junior quarterback, 6'6", 245.
Yeah, we've not seen him so far tonight. But we will see a punt coming up from Paquette, waiting back at the 16-yard line. Looking the rugby kicker, got it away high. Got a pretty good distance on it. Taylor will back away because it's going out of bounds somewhere outside the USF 40-yard line. And that's where they're going to mark it. First and 10, St. Francis will have very good field position on top here with 7:39 remaining in this third quarter over visiting Olivet Nazarene University 45-9.
Again, hats off to the St. Francis defense, giving another opportunity with great field position to the St. Francis offense here as they take over first and 10 at their own 40-yard line. A lot of times with a punt, something like this, you could see anything in between the 10-yard line to the 30, but St. Francis starting out with some very good field position here throughout the game.
Some of the new numbers now checking in, and among others, we'll see Bryce Tolley coming into the game for the first time tonight. And let's see if that's Jarzab in at quarterback. It is.
It
screens the ball. He's got a catch near side. Cut to the 40, 45. That screen spins away. Nice move in midfield. Looking for more yardage into Tiger territory down to the 46-yard line. And some nifty footwork again by Justin Green.
Justin Green, absolutely. But a great downfield block by number one Gaston that got him an extra 40 yards right at the 50-yard line. Gaston comes back from his receiver position and pops a defensive back in pursuit, which gave number 17, Justin Green, an additional 4 yards.
Green will stay in as the running back. Jarzab is the quarterback. Brad's numbers a year ago, 23 carries for 18 yards. He did score 4 rushing touchdowns. Option run, deep handoff. Here's Green, looks for a hole. Angles to his left, breaks one tackle, fights to the 40, and falls just inside the 40-yard line. Lucas coming up to stop. Make that tackle defensively out of the safety spot was Lucas Lindberg.
Second and 4.
That'll be a gain of 6 for Green. And we'll take the clock down to 6:42 remaining in this third quarter. Monty McDowell in. Gomez Espino's in, wide to the right. Split inside of him in the slot position is Charles Gaston. Jarzab keeps it on the ground. And second effort. Run inside will be a carry inside the 38 down to about the 37-yard line.
P.J. Dean on the carry that time, the 187-pound freshman out of Eastside.
So we're seeing some depth at a lot of different positions. Meanwhile, Bryce Tolley stays in as a wingback, also up on the right side. Third down and 1. And a blast play up the middle. And Dean again struggles. Dean, he's got the first down. He fights his way down to the 35-yard line.
Hits the hole very nicely. Powerful run that time. They had him by the shoestring and was able to bring him down. But not before he was able to stretch that play out and get a first down.
A lot of guys looking for playing time. This is a good spot to get it. Trevon Carr checks in now. He's a 204-pound sophomore. First time I believe he's been out there tonight and sets up part of a trips package wide to the right side. Gonna have to get out the roster, Shine. It's gonna be working time
exactly
now.
Exactly right.
Here's Jarzab, wants to throw, short drop, looks, throws as far as he can, left side. He's got Coat out there, he's got it! Touchdown, Seth Coat. He leaped, he backpedaled and caught it and kept position to the turf. 35-yard touchdown off the catch by Seth Coat, his first of the night at the 5:26 mark.
What an athletic move by Coat to go up and get that ball and bring it down with confidence. Just tremendous out there in the left side corner of the USF end zone. Can't say enough about Coat on grabbing that ball out of the sky and bringing it down.
Hey, when Jarzab showed he's got some mustard too on that throw.
Yes.
And Seth Coat, which just a picture perfect catch, a highlight type film catch. Well, that helps when you're 6'4". Went up and got it and carried it through to the turf as the kick is on the way. And that is good. And suddenly it's 52-9 here at Darcy Stadium. So good crowd on opening night. Look to our right in the Bruce Dye Football Training Center area where the stands are. A lot of fans down in there enjoying the game here tonight. And you look around the stadium, a lot of fans just ringing the stadium on the outside, and of course a pretty much full house here on the near home side. I tell you what, it looks like Olivet Nazarene, if those are visiting fans, good turnout from Bourbonnais as well.
You bet. Very well attended tonight. Beautiful night for football here on the Fort, coming to you live from Darcy Stadium. A great venue right here. Brand new Kevin Donnelly Field turf here, field. So, again, we look forward to a lot of great football action here. And what a home opener, Joe, to put up 52 here in the first three quarters. If they can continue this type of threat throughout the season, St. Francis could be looking at a great season ahead.
Well, that lead, you know, it seems like just a moment ago we were talking about a lead of 22. Suddenly it's up to 42 points. My math is correct. I'm not sure it is.
Well, don't look to me for checking.
That's
not
going
to happen. That's right.
So Nix has been a busy guy between kicking field goals tonight, 43 yards tonight, extra points, kickoffs. We've not seen Josh Spitnail that often, and don't take this the wrong way, but that's the way you like it.
Because darn right.
When he's been called upon, he has answered. And, you know, even the one where he had to deaden it, he did exactly, he had the right touch, didn't want it to go in for a touchback, buried at ONU back deep. So it's been, all in all, a very good night. End over end kick coming near side. This time it'll be Deloach at the 10, 15, 20. Looking, gets to the 25 and runs into a wall there. Maybe another yard to the 26.
Very similar to the last kickoff for St. Francis, stopping the return man near the 25-yard line. So again, great special teams play by the Cougars all around and being very consistent in their defense.
Awesome.
What a lead of 43. I just need some time sometimes. 5:02 remaining, clock is running. Zach Gross will stay in there at quarterback. Now they've got this shift. Glanders, one of them, coming over to the left side. And whistles blow.
Fans with that touchdown, two lucky fans just want to push dinner from our
let's
friends.
Let's see what happens
fish.
Here as the officials call
the
it out.
Portland's best fish and tenderloin.
Please put 5:01 on the clock. It'll start on snap. 5:01.
Grant Perkins is also checked in to the ONU lineup. They've got Alvin Best as a wideout to the left side. Cougars really just one safety back at this point. They're trying to load the middle and take away the run. Gaiman is
please
wide to the right.
5:01. That's 5:01 on the clock. It'll start on the snap.
Randy Effner trying to get the clock synchronized and
trying to put 13 more seconds back on. It was at 4:48. Still at 4:48.
Yeah, clock guy is saying, how about I just wait till that all wait 13
yeah,
seconds.
That's right.
Well, you got some new folks working in the press box.
There we go.
Thank you.
Just have to have patience.
Opening night jitters.
There you go.
All around.
Motion again left to right. Behind the line of scrimmage, they hand it off on the sweep. That's Blanders, I believe, and spins across the 30. Got it out to the 30-yard line. He looks taller than 6'1", doesn't he?
Yeah, he surely does. And unfortunately for the Cougar defense, defensive end Jordan May was just a hand away from trapping him in the backfield, but enough speed to get around that corner to get a nice gain for the Tigers that way.
That's a gain of about 8, so second down and short. Gross again, wanting to run the ball again, looking for running room. New running back is in there. Oh, boy, that got cleaned up in a hurry. And I want to see who's clapping their hands coming out of the pile. Let's give some credit, I think, that time defensively to Devin Green.
Yeah, I think you're right. Green came up. Actually, I think Marcus Stepp, number 31, was in there as well from his linebacker position from Bishop Dwenger.
Third down and short, motion again. There was, let's see if there's, oh, they've got a first down. And that's Gross on the keeper play for the quarterback. Carries it out across the 40 to the 42-yard line. I thought there was motion, maybe movement across the defensive line of scrimmage, but no penalty, no harm, no foul, except first down for ONU.
Yeah, that's exactly right. The fake the handoff quarterback keeper right up the gut, and it pays off for the Tigers.
By number 99, Jordan May.
Trying to jockey some new numbers. Now Glanders comes in and sets up in the slot to the near side. Gross out of the pistol. Looking to hand that ball off, and nothing there. And Lucas Spartanarchek had a defensive play
stop
coming in. And
Jordan
give that credit to Drew Durnell.
Right.
A good stop in the first half.
Yeah, just shaking off his tackler or a blocker and penetrating into the defense for a nice 2-yard loss.
Elvin Caldwell is now in the ball game as one of the running backs. Flanders now, they flip-flop him to the left side. So it's second down after the loss, second and 12. Gross, let's see if he tries to go to the air, wants to pass, pump fake, now puts it up. He's got a man wide open out there, but that one's incomplete. That ball hung up and allowed the Cougar defense to come over and make the play.
I think that was Trevin Wilson, number 29, the defensive back, 5'11", 183 sophomore out of Northrop, that's doing a nice job being right there to block that pass.
So now third down and long. Tigers trying to reach the Cougar 48-yard line on this particular snap. Cougars have got Lee Stewart in the secondary position. They'll run the ball, kind of a strange call on third down and long, as they'll have a couple of yards only up to about their 43-yard line.
Yeah, the St. Francis Cougars, they've really not been fooled by that fake jet sweep all night. You know, they've been accustomed to the quarterback tucking and running through the middle. So a small gain there as the defensive interior was not fooled for a second.
Cale Tabler runs out. He remains the punt returner for St. Francis with 2:52 remaining. Seems like we should be at the end of the game or not. It's just still late in this third quarter. And once again, it'll be Paquette in there to punt the ball away. Good delivery to him. Rush is coming, got it away. Sails a beauty.
Wow.
Taylor's got to chase it down inside the 15-yard line. He's back to the 10, looking for some running room. We won't find that. Able to get back only to the 15-yard line, but holds on. And St. Francis now will go back to offense.
12,
we've seen Brad Jarzab most recently at quarterback, and we'll see who the quarterback du jour will be on this series coming up.
Well, interesting too, Joe. They've got some really not-so-good field position here, which is they're not accustomed to. Obviously, that was a beautiful punt and great coverage by the Tigers that time, shackling the Cougars back at the 16-yard line.
Yeah, Paquette last week on punts, he had four of them, and he had a long of 45 yards, averaged over 36 yards a punt. It is Jarzab back in there at quarterback now with a running back lined up behind. They'll hand it off, a cut to the right side, and a carry out across short of the 20 to about the 19-yard line.
T-Rone Young on
that
the carry.
That was T-Rone Young on the carry that time out of Warren Central.
Jonah Moore, number 96, and number 9.
So Kevin Downey getting a chance to get a lot of long looks with his coaching staff at some of the young players. That's one of the luxuries when you are up by 43 points. And still with just about 2 minutes remaining in this third quarter. New number in there wide left is Nate Carson. At Jarzab, let's see, on second and 6, he'll run the ball. And again, second effort out across the 20 to the 21-yard line. And again, the carry was to Teron Young.
Well, what a thrill for these young kids, not only to be in there, but again, here we are on Saturday night, under the lights, beautiful venue, packed house. And this has to be just a thrill for these underclassmen here to get some really quality playing time out on the field.
St. Francis trying to reach their own 26-yard line on this third down call coming up, third down and three. Minute 20 remaining here in the quarter. Jarzab wants to throw, looks near sides, got the catch. That's Carson, spins away. Yes. He's out across the 25 to the 27-yard line and move the chains. So Cougars take what the Tigers give them, and it'll be first and 10.
Good situational awareness by Carson that time to know where he had to stop. He had enough for a first down. The pass was right there and goes down with a first down.
Trevon Carr stays in. He's up in the slot to the near side, the short side of the field. Young stays in as the running back. And Jarzab, the quarterback, on the draw, hands it off, cut to the left side. There's Young to the 30, to the 35, 40. Spun around from behind, a strong yard run again. Good luck in Youngster, Tyrone Young.
Boy, oh boy, he's got some moves, he's got some speed. Great athleticism on display but there by the young man for the St. Francis Cougars. Getting another nice first down.
And out of Warren Central, you kind of expect that, don't you?
Yeah,
out of
that's exactly right.
Talented program.
Yep, you bet. That's a program that can do it all, not only on the ground but in the air as well. And that's why they are recruited heavily.
Trips package to the right side, including Gomez Espino. And a blitz being shown up the middle. Here's the stretch handoff right side. And looking for some running room is Young. And cuts it up the middle across the 45. Just short of midfield. It'll be tackled at the 49 of St. Francis.
That might do it for the third quarter, Jim.
It will. It'll be 52-9 as we'll head to the fourth quarter. But impressive performance so far. Cougars with 52 on the board after three quarters here at home. This is Cougar Football and Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Have one read, I believe.
All right, Cougar fans. We want to thank all of you tonight for participating with the Score More app promotion on your phones tonight. We do have a couple winners already to announce. We've got two winners of game used jerseys. If you didn't participate in the Score More promotion tonight, you can do it at homecoming and every other home game. But we've got Alex here from Score More.
We're back at Darcy Stadium. Welcome back, everybody. With Sean
the
McBride,
first
Joe Carson checking in, and
Kindlesparger.
Lots of points on
this
scoreboard. Sean has been
jersey.
Very impressive.
We will contact you Monday. Make sure
it
we
surely
get
has,
to
Joe,
you.
Especially for a home opener.
And
what
two,
I've noticed here in the second half, Joe,
Ruby
too,
Tietzel.
The mistakes
Ruby
have
Tietzel.
Virtually gone away, especially with a lot
you
of the young players that are in there
jersey.
Right now. You know, St. Francis was really plagued by a lot of penalties and in the first half, and they've really quieted down here in the second half.
Cougars had 21 points on the board in the first quarter. They've come back with 21 more now in this third quarter and lead it 52-9 as we head to live action now in this fourth quarter. Here's a handoff and a cutback to the right side and into the 45-yard line and down to the 42-yard line. The Cougars have got a first down as they'll stay with that running back and impressive reading the blocks, Tyrone Young.
Well, you're exactly right. And it looks like there was some miscommunication. I think Young thought it might be a stretch play when Jarzab thought it was going to be an interior cut on the left side. But here's that athleticism again on display to cut it back to the right side and get some nice positive yards on that run.
Jarzab basically keeping the ball on the ground, and why not? Young has been running with some abandon for St. Francis. Wing back up on the right side, but now he does want the throw. Sets up in the pocket, throws right side, looking down in the corner of the end zone. He's got a man, but that's ruled just no catch. Tended down the right corner for Gomez Espino.
Wow, that could have, I thought, been called right there as the defender was beaten. Espino had him, and the ball was right there, and it looked like the defender went to push Espino right when the ball was coming. That's kind of suspect, but we'll call it an incomplete pass.
By the way, the full name, that is Andreas Gomez Espino.
Very close.
Out of Snyder, very close to a first or a touchdown, but no good, and it'll come back second and 10 at the ONU 43-yard line. Jarzab begin now, looking and looks to hand it off, read option. It's play action fake, and he's going to be buried. Waited too long.
Yeah. Good penetration that side from the backside for the Tigers there as number 40 gets in. A nice sack there. And, of course, we're going to call him out as Corbin Hesterberg.
Sebastian Swift, one of the linebackers, also there making the pursuit. So a loss of five. Brings up third down and 15. Now the Cougars trying to reach the 33-yard line of ONU. Olivet Nazarene back home next Saturday night. Another night game coming up. They'll take on Lindenwood Belleville. Here's Jarzab dropping the throw. The rush is on. Scramble steps up, looking, spun around, and nowhere to go. He's dropped Jarzab back at his own 49-yard line.
Yeah, again, the protection collapsed that time. St. Francis not able to really get anything done on that play, so that's going to be another tackle for loss and a sack.
Well, we mentioned new numbers. We're seeing them with the skill position players. Jack Baker got in there to run some numbers on the offensive line, I should say. But it'll be fourth down, and we'll see Josh Spitnail in. I believe this is only his third punt of the night.
Yeah, I think you're right. I just got handed the third quarter stats from Bill, and we're going to check right here. Yeah, up until now, he's only had two punts for an average of 39 yards per punt.
Cougars were short a man. Play clock is going to run out. They'll take the five-yard penalty. Little things.
5 yards on the offense.
Coaches just kind of look at players. You are on the punt team, aren't you?
That's right.
You should know that, though, when it's fourth down and everybody else who your position players run out there, you probably should be out there, too.
Right.
A little sarcasm on a late Saturday night. Spitnail, low snap, got it away, and that got a beautiful spiral kick. And that one, and boy, was there a fair catch called? I'm not sure there was, but it'll be. Oh, and you ball back around the 16-yard line. That was Deloach. I never saw him raise a hand, and he took a chance, and he caught the ball and slid down and maintained possession.
Well, and the St. Francis defender was right there when he was catching the ball. I think he had to go down onto the turf to actually get it. So no yards after the catch that time for the Tigers.
Now, there is the big guy we were looking at.
Yes.
In warm-ups. That is Dirks, who's 6'6". In there, the third quarterback of the night used by Brian Fish. Looks and he does hand it off to Best on a sweep. Working right side, and he cartwheels across the 15. Didn't get back to the line of scrimmage, though. He's going to lose a yard, I believe, to the 16-yard line.
Marcus Stepp on his outside linebacker position. The stud from Bishop Dwyer coming in with a nice tackle for loss there.
Another one of those young troops that Kevin Donnelly says can play right now, along with Pearson Harnish out of Norwell. Dirks again wants to throw. Backpedal, steps up, throws to the right. He's got a man. That one was nearly intercepted. USF had it in their hands. In and out of the hands that time defensively back there. And it was a Stanford Jackson.
Yeah, he had it in his hands and unfortunately couldn't pull it in for an interception. So that's just going to be another burn down for the Tigers.
Third down and 10. Ball's at the 17-yard line, and Dirk steps in there at quarterback once again, looking to throw the out. He's got a catch. Short Glanders has got it. And second effort spins across the 25. Short of the first down, I believe, by a yard and a half.
It's going to be close.
See where they mark it. Well, they gave him a good spot. They're going to give him a first down.
The spot of the night.
Wow.
Yeah.
I thought he was short by at least a yard and a half. I think we're seeing arena football again. Give you that extra little consideration. Dirks out of the gun, looking to hand the ball off. They run it on the ground, not much there. Short of the 30-yard line, the running play up to the 28. Some new numbers in there both ways.
Yeah, it looks like Steph's going to come out, and Davin Robinson, a defensive back, is going to check in. Another true freshman out of Warren Central, number 42 for the Cougars in now.
Sam Trader's in there as the running back now for the Tigers. Gain of 1, second down and 9. Dirks looking to run the ball again.
Oh, boy.
That one is eaten up as Drew Gurnell read that play all the way. Is there a penalty flag thrown?
Yeah, late flag here on the close sidelines here. Now, there was some single coverage going out here of the wide receiver and the cornerback.
Best got involved with Johnny Cooper. No, check it. It's Shatan Harris. And let's see which way this one is going to go. Well, you're trying to catch the eye of the coaches, but
good. Unnecessary roughness. Number 12 on the defense.
Yep. Oh, boy.
That's 15 yards from the end of the play. Automatic. First down.
That's not the way to do it.
Not the way to do it. That's exactly right.
He's out of south side. Well, as I said, trying to make a mark, but hopefully it's a positive mark.
Tigers on the ball.
Yeah, that one was not. 30th. Fresh set of downs now for the Tigers.
Lee Stewart is the safety in there right now for St. Francis. As Dirk, short drop, looks to throw near side. Got a catch at the 42. And a run after the catch up to about the 45-yard line as David Payne came out of the backfield. Senior running back. So the Tigers trying to stay with what they do. And at this point in the ball, even though 10:49 remaining, Sean, you just say, hey, it's a new game. We'll play like it's 0-0, see what we can do, and build for next week.
That's exactly right.
Nice throw across the way, and that's a catch by Gaiman, I believe, out there for a first down. So they'll move the chains for the Tigers up close to midfield.
Really, so far, this is a pretty sustained drive by Olivet, of course, helped by the big personal foul that time, but haven't seen Olivet offense on the field quite so often, except maybe in the first quarter.
And you get the feeling watching Dirks that he's pretty much committed to the pass, obviously partly because of the score, but because he's 6'6", 235, they run up the middle into a wall.
And there's nothing there.
Nothing there.
They've been able to hit the flats consistently on that passing attack, so why they're trying the middle, I do not know.
That'll be a tackle for loss of at least a half a yard. And how are they going to mark that ball back at the line of scrimmage at the 49?
Not in this current reality.
No. But that's the way it goes. It'll be second down in 10. And Dirk's looking to hand. Oh, he throws the ball knocked down. It is knocked away. Trying to go over the middle to Deloach with a quick hitting play after the quick fake up the middle.
Yeah, a little interior slant that time. He threw the ball behind the receiver, and unfortunately he wasn't able to wrangle it in. So just another incomplete pass.
Third down and long. Payne stays in as the running back. Clock stopped on the incompleted ball. Still 9:48 remaining. Dirks backs the throw. Sets his feet. Looks right. Throws right. And a wide open catch. Whether St. Francis just giving a big cushion out there. And an easy pitch and catch. And now they'll have first down at the USF inside the 40-yard line at the 39.
Yeah, you know, this the quarterback really hasn't gone long at all. So as a defensive back, you have to consider that there's going to be stick routes, there's going to be some hitches involved, maybe a slant. But, you know, he really hasn't gone down the field much whatsoever. So they might want to keep that in mind in their coverage package.
Stanford Jackson's got the coverage assignment on Rashawn Gaiman out there, and he's given him about a 7-yard cushion to start with. And Dirks is looking that way all the way. Blitz coming defensive right side. Here's a quick slant. Deloach has got it hit immediately, but it'll be a gain of about 7, maybe 8 yards. Quick slant pattern was there, and Dirk's warming up. No pretense what he's about. They're out there to throw that football.
That's exactly right.
Second down and short. Clock will move close to 9 minutes. Time remaining. Motion. And here's Payne with the out pass and tripped up. Good open field tackle that time as coming across into the second. That was Marcus Stepp again.
True freshman coming out of Bishop Dwenger, making a nice open field tackle that time.
And well schooled in fundamentals. Cougars trying to make a change defensively. Got to hurry because they're out there ready to play. There's motion to the right side, and there's going to be another timeout called by St. Francis, saving the penalty, and they'll have to work on that because teams will try to exploit that with the hurry-up offense.
Well, you know, when teams look that over in film, that is an excellent thing to consider, Joe, is that St. Francis cannot get set up early. So let's rush that tempo, and get them off the balls of their feet.
8:56 remaining here tonight at Darcy Stadium. 52-9 is our score. Let's take a 30-second break. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, RWRDF 106.3 FM. See the marching band, hey, didn't
Cougar
we?
No, we did. Did they march?
Marched off.
Watch live streaming action of Cougar Athletics and get the latest game write-ups at stfranciscougars.com, where all Cougar fans go.
By the way, we'll see if we get an update on that Notre Dame score. Last report, that was late in the first half. They were up 14-0 on Texas. Here it's 52-9 USF. Ran out to a 21-0 lead. Then it was 21-9 and big third quarter, 21 more points on the board by USF. Best in motion. And they'll give the ball to him on a sweep, and he's got the corner again. Cuts to the 26-yard line. knocked down once again. Good pursuit from the wide side by Stanford Jackson.
Yeah, Jackson did a very nice job shedding his downfield block coming in and taking out his legs. That could have been a much bigger gain that time. So nice open field tackle.
Best last week had a couple of carries for 5 yards and picks up four there. Second down and six from the right side hash mark. They run it up the middle. And here's an off tackle run.
Let's
see if that was David Payne getting the call as he brings it inside the USF 25 down to about the 23.
Third and four.
Interesting down here, Joe. Let's see what the Cougars can do facing a third and four on defense.
Third down and four. Bunch lineup now with one wide out to the right. And here's Dirks, looks near side. He's got a bobbled catch. And nothing doing. Good open field tackle once again. USF stops it for minimal gain. That was Damon Robinson.
Yeah, out of Warren Central again, doing a nice job, a great open field tackle. Again, trying to get their playmakers in space for the Tigers, but that fast defense from the Cougars does not allow for a good positive gain.
Sean, very fascinating. A lot of names we've never mentioned before. But getting a chance here tonight when your team is up 52-9.
And really doing a fine job.
Exactly.
Joe.
There's no let off. Dirks, short drop, looks over the middle, steps up, throws to the corners, got Payne out there, grabs the ball. Did he hold on? He's got a touchdown.
Wow.
Good effort. That'll be a 24-yard touchdown. And Dirks at the 7:19 mark. Good for 34 yards.
And that's the longest pass that we've seen Dirks throw that time. He put a lot of air underneath it, allowed his receiver to get underneath it, and a nice score that time for the Tigers.
And good job by Payne as well to go up and get it. He's only, 5'9".
He used all of that.
So Paquette comes on to attempt the extra point. That'll make it 52-15. Low snap, they got the kick down, and it's away and on, and it's good. So, tack a touchdown on for ONU, a little late heroics, 52-16 though. St. Francis still up big. We'll be back in 30 seconds. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Hopefully you're still there, Robert. Gotcha. Thank you, sir. To 16, our score here at Darcy Stadium. In the second half, the third quarter score, it is Notre Dame in the lead over Texas 17-0. On to Taylor University next Saturday night under the lights again. Kickoff at 7, a pregame on Redeemer Radio begins at 6:45. Now let's see, Charles Gaston goes back in kick return. He'll be joined back there by P.J. Dean. I wouldn't be surprised. Let's see if there's a little trickery in the mind of Brian Fish right here.
Well,
7:19 to go.
Now might be a time to try it.
Nope. Going to kick it deep. Gaston lines it up. He's got it inside the 10. Works straight out front to the 15-20. He breaks the tackles and then hauled down.
Gaston
got across the 25 to the 27-yard line. Needed just one more little run. He was trying to work his way out to the left side, and he had some space out there.
Well, we'll break out the roster again, Joe, here with 52-16 is the score. 7:12 to go in the contest. Again, we're going to see some clean jerseys out there, I would imagine. A lot of youngsters getting some great playing time for the Cougars tonight.
Yeah, let's see. Brad Jarzab does come back out to run the offense. And P.J. Dean as well is the running back. You expect a steady diet of runs at this point. And here is a run by Dean off the left side. He's kept his footing, and he's out across the 30, 35, 40. He's got a chance inside the 40, and he's in a foot race, and he is gone. P.J. Dean to the house. He'll take it from his own 27-yard line, some 73 yards for a touchdown run at the 6:57 mark.
Just fantastic. Not only was Dean an exceptional athlete on that play, but look at that downfield blocking by his receivers, keeping those lanes open and giving him an opportunity to score. What a fantastic play.
One play drive once again. Second time tonight we've seen. We started the ball game with an 80-yard touchdown pass from Ferrer to Cam Smith. So the Cougars bounce right back on the P.J. Dean touchdown. And he was pulling away from pursuers also. Extra point kick, right-footed kick is on the way. And that is good. We'll keep things right here.
Ryan Nix's kick is good.
It is. I thought maybe we had a new kicker in there, but it is Ryan Nix. I see 88 in there. So that will make it 59-16 with a timeout. We'll keep things right here and talk about this bevy of talent that's beginning to show itself and some depth. At least potential depth. I know one game is kind of tough to make a decision on some of that.
Well, you're exactly right, Joe. But at the same time, here it is, the confidence given to these young men out on the field tonight because they aren't giving the game away. You know, the defense is stout. Look at this high-powered offense on the field. P.J. Dean right there scorches them on one play. So this has to really give the coaching staff a real boost that they've really done an exceptional job in recruiting these young men to come out and play for the Cougars.
I was hoping I could see the scores from last year. I don't have that material with me, but 59 points has got to rank as the most points in a ball game for St. Francis over the last 2 years, right at the top. I can't remember. I don't have that piece of paper at hand right at the moment. But very impressive still with 6:57 remaining in this ball game.
Lots of time left.
Interesting. Now, Gaiman and Deloach lined up initially in tandem. Trying to confuse perhaps Ryan Nix or it's Spitnail that's going to come out there now to kick the ball away. Gaiman is the deeper of the two kick returners inside the five at about the three. Spitnail trying to nail it high into rim. Gaiman runs up. He's got it at the two. Straight ahead to the 10, 15. Looking for running room. And cuts back and nice. He evaded some tacklers. Across the 20 to the 25 up to about the 27 is where Olivet Nazarene goes to work offensively.
So nice 25-yard return that time for the Tigers. And they're going to take over with 6:48 to go here in the contest. And again, well, it'd be interesting to see what kind of package comes out here on defense and the numbers for the Cougars, as some of those guys not only play on special teams, but now they might be out there for the defense as well.
And Dirks is going to stay in, obviously, at quarterback, the 6'6" quarterback. He hands the ball off, and Payne caught the touchdown pass, spins away, and got across the up to around the 30-yard line with a nice second effort.
And, Joe, half of that success was the offense was down and set, and the Cougars were still running onto the field.
Yeah, that's something they've got to clean up. These teams are playing up tempo, and that's going to continue to be a factor. So a gain of four, second down and six. And play action fake. Here's Dirks, throws near side, looking downfield and a little bit too far, looking for Alvin Best. Wheel route out of the backfield down the left sidelines. And about a step on the defender.
Yeah, I was just going to say, he had a step, not much more there, as he was pretty well guarded, but just overthrown that time on the, like you said, the wheel right out of the backfield.
Another new number, and that's Emmanuel Evans has come in, has got the coverage on Best near side. Second down and 10, 6:15 remains on the clock. Dirks, this has been the alignment all night long, the pistol alignment, blitz coming defensive right side by St. Francis. Dirks loads up, throws to the left, he's got a catch.
Or does he? That's the question. I think he dropped it, Joe.
Now they're going to bring it back.
Yeah.
No catch. Looked like a pretty good. You know, you always want to put it to the backside out there to try to keep it away from the defender. Back shoulder throw. But they rule it no good, and it'll bring up fourth down, and it'll be a punt coming up for Olivet Nazarene. David Payne, I think, is going to be the punter this time for the Tigers. USF making late substitution once again. Is that Jarrell Holman? Did I catch his name?
I think so, yeah.
Return. He waits back at the St. Francis 35. So Payne gets the kick away high. Wobbly ball. That one is going to hit at the 40. Takes a Tiger bounce of about 4 yards and comes to a stop. It's touched right at the USF 36-yard line.
Well, again, the St. Francis Cougars hold the Olivet Tigers to a three and out that time. So, again, fresh jerseys or not, these kids came to play. And St. Francis Cougars defense just doing a fantastic job tonight, regardless of who's in there, Joe.
And who is in there now? It's going to be Jarzab coming out once again to engineer the offense. And as far as the running back, they'll stay with
I think that's Young, number 27.
Yeah, Tyrone Young back in there as the running back. And they'll give him the ball. And breaks off a tackle, runs into a little bit of a block at the 35. And shuffles his way out to the left side and gets a couple of more yards. So it'll be a net gain. Let's call it 2 yards gain. Second down and 8.
Second down.
Well, I think at this point in time, the St. Francis Cougars should be very happy with keeping the ball on the ground. Safe plays, maybe moving the chains a couple times, trying to build a drive here. But most importantly, let's just get out of this game with a nice big win.
And keep people healthy. We've not seen any of the Cougars really go down tonight.
No.
Had a couple of injuries for the Tigers. Sweep coming off right side. And there's Young, breaks a tackle at the 40, and good hard-nosed run. Gets another yard gained up to about the 41.
Talk about number 77 there. That is Jalen Gamble doing a fine job getting outside. He's from North Central and really laying a lick on a defender out here on the close sidelines. We could hear that collision from up here.
You know, an interesting point talking about some of the people you've talked about, Sean. You know, the knock has been, well, Marion's taken all the guys from Indianapolis, but not necessarily, because you mentioned a couple of Warren Central players tonight, most recently the North Central player, former player. So St. Francis still able to get some talent from the Central Indiana part. Jarzab wanting to throw, in trouble, flush to the right, scrambling, looking, throw it away, and nearly throw it right into the hands of one of the Tigers.
Yeah, number 40 that time he had it. He is a linebacker. We've talked about him before, Hesterberg, and it was right there at his shoulder pads, but he's not accustomed to catching the ball, Joe.
So the Cougars go three and out. Josh Spitnail will come on to punt the ball away. Still 4:48 on the clock here late in this fourth quarter. Spitnail waits for the snap back around the USF 27-yard line. And no rush, got it away, spirals one again. That one coming down at the 15, and no fair catch. That's a mistake.
Wow. He got depleted.
The punt returner that time, you catch the defense. That was Aaron Salas, who took the chance and paid the price.
Stanford Jackson, number 23, came in. Defensive back out of Bishop Chittard High School.
Another Indy recruit.
Now, he did some celebrating after the play. This might be against St. Francis.
Dead ball after the play was completed. Unsportsmanlike punting, number 30, 15 yards, automatic first down.
So that went against St. Francis. Taunting is what the penalty was.
Yep.
That goes on Spencer Coward, but, you know, fine line there. You want to celebrate, and you don't want to take the fun out of the game. But again, if it is taunting, you know, that shouldn't stand either.
Well, and the coach's message there, let your play do the talking, not your mouth. You know, that's exactly right.
Dale Dirks has thrown for a touchdown, and now he lost the ball and has to scramble back on it, back inside his own 20-yard line. Well, getting late in the evening, and the dew kind of coming in off Mirror Lake. Looks to be a little hazy out there now. Maybe that's the barbecue grills, right?
It might be. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance tonight, so maybe next time.
Yeah, me and my diet. Here's motion to the right. Dirks looking to screen the ball. He's got a catch. Run across the 20 to about the 22-yard line. That might have been Salas back in there.
Well, the important part for the Cougars, he was caught inbounds, so the clock continuing to run down after that reception. And really not much of a game whatsoever.
Yeah, that is Aaron Salas, senior wide receiver, 5'8", 176. Recruited out of California. I noticed they recruit really coast to coast. A lot of Florida kids, West Coast kids. But it's second down and long, third down and long. And here's Dirk sets up. They got a hand on him, throws anyway, and throws it wide, incomplete, looking for Deloach.
Yeah, nice backside pressure that time by the St. Francis Cougars. He had his hand on his jersey and was pulling him. I don't know if that threw the pass off, but it didn't matter because it was an incomplete pass anyway. Brings up a fourth down.
Yeah, second time in a row that ONU is going to go three and out. And St. Francis now with the chance to get pretty good field position on this. Drill Homan back and punt return once again. Backs up to about his own 42-yard line. It takes a hit count. Make sure he's got 10 other guys out there in the blue uniforms. St. Francis had a little problem with that. Here's the snap. Rushes on, but the kick is away. And Holman lets it bounce once right to him at the 39. Returns to the 45, and he is wrapped up and driven down. Good open field tackle once again.
Stop made by number 51.
And now this is what I really don't understand, Joe, is that his forward progress, he was hit at the 45. They're going to mark this one at the 42.
Out of the field.
I just don't get it.
Yeah.
I really don't.
Are we in Canton, Ohio again?
Something must be. I don't know what the deal is there, but he was clearly driven back 5 yards after his forward progress. So
we used to kid in the old days, you know, Malone and Walsh, the Canton handicapper, it was plus 10 for the home team, negative 2 for the visitors. But that cost him a good 3 yards on that very poor spot of the ball. First and 10. You don't mind it much when you're up 59-16. But come on, guys.
Yeah.
What do we have? An injured player that was it. Was that Dirks? No, check it.
No, that's number 9, Gino
Prestia.
Prestia, yeah.
Didn't see what happened on the kick return, but he's walking off the field but favoring his left leg. Well, it's been enough tough night physically for the they lost a couple of Tiger offensive linemen earlier in the ball game. Then the quarterback Ray went out. Now Prestia. First and 10, Jarzeb hands it off, run right side. Good second effort.
That's a New Jersey.
Yeah, it is, and it's going to be Micah McDorsett.
DJ Manning on the carry.
Check that, Joe. I think that was 22.
Manning.
DJ Manning, yes, yeah. DJ Manning in there. After Kid Bill Scott print those numbers a little bit.
I tell you what, I don't know how he does it, because I surely can't.
He got 140 guys out there. And about everybody's going to try to play in a game like tonight. 2:50, less than 3 minutes time remaining. Second down, and here's some running room, not room, I should say. And the game will be up across the 47 to the 48-yard line.
Manning on the carry.
Manning again on the carry. He is a 6-foot, 193-pound junior out of St. Mary's, Ohio.
Played for the Rough Riders.
Third and 6.
They've gotten a few star players out of St. Mary's,
Went
over to Ohio. And of course, one I know a lot of Cougar fans are hoping is somewhere along the line, Grant Sherman, a transfer out of Kenton High School, who still holds a number of all-time passing records over in the state of Ohio, and that says something. Jarzab wants to throw, but he's eaten up again.
Well, great play that time by the defensive, let's see here, I think that was 96 coming in with the pressure for Olivet. He was able to shed that block by the running back that time and get back in there and really cause some havoc for the quarterback.
That's Jonah Moore.
Yeah.
Jonah Moore, who came in, he had 3 tackles last week, 1 for loss. He had a sack, and he gets a sack there. So the Cougars are going to have to punt the ball away once again. Clock is moving. We're approaching 90 seconds time remaining. And Spindell trying to unload a good one again. Waits at his 25. Rush is coming. Got it away, though. And they hit him. No penalty flag thrown.
Wow. Spindell gets up. Seems to be okay, thank goodness.
Their catch by number 1, Aaron Salas.
Guess the officials want to go home, too. Looked at it and did not throw the flag. That was Benjamin Toberman that came in there and did knock down Spindell. So it'll be last gasp attempt. Dirks comes back out there. He's thrown for 1 touchdown and relief in the second half. A relief role at quarterback. Hit a 34-yard touchdown pass. Hooked up with David Payne. Really a nice catch for them. And now tries to throw again. Looking for the out pattern. Gaiman is there. Has it at the 33. Oh, they separated the ball. Good hard-hitting defense.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Right there at the catch was the defensive back. And that's Emmanuel Evans, number 24. Check that.
Yeah, you're right.
Is it? Okay, they list him as a wide receiver, but he separated the ball from the receiver, so great hit that time.
I think Beto Tupia is in the lineup also. And I have no idea if I'm pronouncing that right. Dirks throwing the home run near side, too far, incomplete. And now, what is that, a penalty flag? Are you kidding me?
Oh, my heavens, you can't be serious. Marcus Stepp was right out there, man for man, right on his shoulder.
Oh, Kevin Donnelly's got to get in the ear of that official. What are you looking at, guys, in the last minutes of this ball game? Some bizarre goings on in the late going with 108.
I don't believe that call for a second.
This will be interesting to hear.
There is no penalty.
All right.
Well, I believe that call. Thank you. Yeah.
You really got to be smoking something to make a call like that.
He was shoulder to shoulder with him. That was great coverage by Step from his outside linebacker position, staying with the receiver. He did nothing wrong.
Guys, if you want to work in the college level, week two, you've got to really clean some of this stuff up.
Yeah.
Minute 8 remains, third down and 10. Dirks waiting for the snap and screens the ball right side. That's too high, incomplete. Trying to swing it out to the right side, but try to get some space.
Pass intended for Eric Anderson.
Eric Anderson, the intended receiver. So fourth down, and once again, Tigers will kick the ball away.
Could very well be the last possession of the game here with 102 remaining here, Joe. What a really impressive opening night for the St. Francis Cougars.
You think this field judge, his ears are ringing a little bit?
Yeah.
I mean, Coach D was about 4 yards onto the field.
Joel Holman deep for the Cougars.
But again, when you've got help, that's what, get it right.
Yep.
Here's the snap. Rugby style kick coming up. No, they're going to run with the ball, and they'll not get the first down. They'll run across the 35-yard line, but wow.
Kind of a poor decision that time. I could understand that if you had 3 yards to go trying to stretch that play out. But the Cougar defense held, played it smart, stayed home. And now the Cougar offense will be in great shape.
I'm just thinking, he figured, you know what, we got less than a minute to play. They're just going to basically take a knee. And I'll take a chance. Maybe I'll get a new set of downs to work with. I don't think he would do that if there was a lot more time remaining.
Well, you're probably right. Now, if I was Andreas Gomez Espino, the wideout on the right side, I'm like, hey, throw it to me. I'll try it.
I was going to say, yeah, they might say, hey, let's go. Now, they do take the victory formation.
Yeah.
And Jarzab will take a knee, so maybe time for one more snap. And it'll go into the books as a 59-16 victory. But I know some coaches, I won't mention names, but they would have thrown the ball in that very next
That's
play.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Wonder how Dale Carlson's doing. We'll see him at the – He is, by the way, I don't know if you've caught the news, but he is the new head man at Lindenwood Belleville. So we'll see him in a few weeks.
Okay.
Remember the longtime Tri-State coach went on to over in Ohio and then to Valparaiso. That'll do it. They'll take another knee, and this will go into the books as a 59-16 USF victory. So impressive performance on opening night. Yes, some ups, a lot of ups, much more than the downs. There were a few of those, a lot of penalties to clean up between week one and week two. But again, very, very positive, very encouraging outcome here tonight for Cougar fans at Varsity Stadium. 59-16, the final score. Let's take a 30-second timeout, and then we'll head into our post-game presentation. This is Cougar Football on Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Okay, let's go into the post-game open, Robert, and we'll save that 60 in the post-game at Ford Financial. Any update on Note ND? 24-3 in the fourth quarter, I presume. Third quarter. Gotcha. Glad to be with you for the season opener at Darcy Stadium under the lights tonight with Sean McBride, Joe Parson with you. And very good performance in the outcome here tonight. Cougars with 21 points in the opening quarter, 21 more in the third quarter. And they come away with a 59-16 victory over the Olivet Nazarene University Tigers. And Sean, all in all, as I mentioned, I'm sure we'll get a look at some of the final numbers before we leave the air, hopefully. But again, a lot to build on. And I think what impressed me more than anything, yes, some great plays with the what you would term the normal starters, but a lot of depth and some impressive backups and young players that are trying to make their mark on this young Cougar football team as well.
Well, you're exactly right, Joe, except for that lone touchdown here on the left side of the end of the at the end of the game here in the fourth quarter. The young pups came in and held the Olivet Nazarene Tigers to 9 points throughout the game. But really, talk about impressive. First of all, the scoreboard, 59-16, obviously. But how the Cougars went about that is really what I found very fascinating. was not only the passing attack, Cam Smith and company, for one, so they do have that big play capability, but the interior line, Joe, was very impressive tonight because what we also saw was a running attack for St. Francis really coming alive tonight. So that balanced attack from the Cougars really led to this score and this impressive performance all night long.
I think you're right on, spot on with that analysis, because St. Francis, yes, the passing game was impressive tonight, but they're going to need the run, certainly.
Yep.
You know, the staple for any winning program is you've got to establish the run normally before you go with the pass to set up the pass. And again, Ferrer with four touchdown passes in the first half alone, but had time. The offensive line gave him the opportunity. And how about the start of this ball game? Because the fans were still coming in. The Cougars got the ball at their own 20-yard line, and it only took them one play to get into the end zone as Ferrer found Cam Smith on a fly pattern. He ran the last 30, 35 yards untouched, got behind the defense, and just like that, on one play, St. Francis is up 7-0.
Yeah, it's incredible. And, you know, that really, to use a couple terms, that we like to info, that'll take the wind out of your sails, or that's going to put your daubers down. And, of course, Olivet really had a tough time coming back from that singular play. It took, what, Joe, 12 seconds, I think, and the Cougars were on the board. So that lends itself to that big play capability from Ferrer to Cam Smith. We've seen Cam Smith be a weapon here for a lot of years. This is his senior year, and he comes out and makes a statement on opening night.
You know, the other little wrinkle I think we saw here tonight was that little shovel pass that is not only just disguised, but it's really deceptive, because Ferrer actually turns away from the play and then gives the ball back on that quick hitting play. He hit Appenzeller for a 13-yard pitch, if you want to call it. It goes as a touchdown pass, 13 yards to make it 14-0. But we saw that several times tonight.
It's just incredible how they have perfected that pass. It's a jet sweep coming right to left across the line of scrimmage. And whether it's Appenzeller or, you know, any of the other receivers coming through there, really Ferrer's ball control and presence right there. The other thing that's interesting, what they could do out of that, Joe, if, in fact, he does decide to keep it and roll out to the right, it was there because, again, that defense was getting sucked in. But it was just such finesse. We've seen it, I think, four times tonight, work very well against the Tigers. So I could see that being a real staple throughout the year for the Cougars using that play.
St. Francis had a couple of fourth down stops against the Tiger defense in that first quarter. Second one set up a one-play, 47-yard touchdown pass. Ferrer found Montay McDowell behind the defense, and he reached the goal line right in the middle of the field, reached across. It did fumble away, but they ruled that he had possession to break the plane of the goal. And it was 21-0 in favor of St. Francis. Now, ONU comes back, a raid to Rashawn Gaiman, who is a good-looking receiver, 46 yards on a touchdown to cut it down to 21-6. Kick was blocked by the Cougar defense. Tabler had an interception, the first of two by St. Francis tonight, but a fumble recovery gave it back, and Paquette hit a 33-yard field goal just before the end of the first quarter to make it 21-9. As far as St. Francis in the second quarter, Ferrer shovel it away to Sean Boswell. This was good for a 7-yard touchdown at the 8:36 mark. A lead of 19 for St. Francis, 28-9. And right before halftime, another positive as Ryan Nix from 43 yards out. He had a long of 40 yards a year ago. This time, his career long 43 yards. That made it 31-9 at halftime, and very impressive.
Very much so. And you talk about leading into the PAT right there, Joe. Let's talk a little bit about the special teams while we're on that subject. Really, I call it four stars throughout the entire game, whether you talk about Spitnail, the punter, or obviously the career-long field goal tonight. The coverage, the kicks, everything went well for St. Francis during the special teams.
Cale Tabler might disagree with you a little bit.
Yeah.
He had the one bell ringer where, you know, God bless him, he made the decision to try to run with the ball, and he got leveled.
Yeah, he got de-cleated on that one. You're absolutely right. But other than that, again, but we saw him pop right up. So, again, this kid's got moxie, and he is a playmaker. There's a reason he's a team captain, because he's tough as nails.
Well, he had an interception tonight, Cale Tabler did, and later in the ball game, in fact, in the second half, Center Coward had a pick at the ONU 28-yard line. That would set up an Aaron Harris touchdown run of 20 yards at the 12:25 mark to make it 38-9. Ferrer passing to Appenzeller for 3 yards at the 8:40 mark. And USF up with 45-9. Jarzab got into the scoring column. as he hit Seth Coate on a nice 35-yard pass play. And that was picture perfect because Coate at 6'4" had to go up and make a play on the ball, and he did at the 5:26 mark. It was 52-9 in favor of St. Francis, up 43 after three quarters.
Yeah, I can't wait to see the highlight film on that. I'm hoping Jeff Mahoney got that one because that was a beautiful, beautiful catch that time in the corner of the end zone for the Cougars, and I can't wait to see that one on film.
Dirks came on. He was the third quarterback used by Brian Fish tonight, and he did hook up with David Payne. That was a nice play in the end zone. A good catch by the 5'9 running back coming out of the backfield. Good for 34 yards. So ONU gets a score at the 7:19 mark, made it 52-16. And the game started with a flourish. We mentioned Ferrer to Cam Smith. First play from scrimmage. How about the last score of the ball game? P.J. Dean, 73 yards on a one-play call as he scrambles for a touchdown at the 6:57 mark. That would be the final points on the board for USF. They win it tonight 59-16.
It all comes out of fundamentals, Joe, and really what we talk about there, fundamentals, we didn't get a chance to talk to Coach Donnelly at the halftime to talk about the penalties, but really a tale of two halves. Really, we saw the penalties really shore up and clean up in the second half. In the first half, you know, they had seven penalties for, 10 penalties for 70 yards at the end of the first half. And at the end of the third quarter, still 10 penalties for 70 yards. So they really cleaned up their act in the second half. So hats off. You know, fundamentals really came through. And, again, we talk about the depth of this football team. It was on display tonight.
59-16, the final. We're going to stop for a final 60-second timeout. And we'll be back with final comments here from Darcy Stadium on a very successful opening night for the University of St. Francis Cougars. Cougar football, Redeemer Radio, WRDF 106.3 FM. Anything else you want to add, sir?
Well, I don't see finals coming from Bill. I don't think we're getting final numbers.
I think they got the backups in there, too.
Okay.
Anything you maybe can glean, I don't know if there's anything on the...
I no idea how to read it, so no, there's nothing here.
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll just set the stage for next week.
Sure.
And 21-3, I believe you said, or 24-3, was it for Notre Dame, Robert? Thank you, sir.
We can plug
is that game at South Bend?
Yeah, okay. I think so. We'll plug our Friday night, too.
Yes. Cougar fans on the field celebrating this St. Francis victory over visiting Olivet Nazarene, 59-16, the final. Got an update from Notre Dame Stadium, 31-3 Irish late in the third quarter. And one of the other statistics I just really popped in my mind, St. Francis shutting out the Tigers in the two middle quarters. And when they came up in those two middle quarters with a total of 31 points. So good dominance, and that was one of the major differences in the Cougar win here tonight, Sean.
Yeah, I agree. The St. Francis Cougar defense really gave the offense more than enough opportunities. It shows on the scoreboard. I will very much look forward to talking about the Cougar defense all season long. And really, Joe, one other final note before we try and get out of here at a reasonable hour is next Friday night. We've got a signature matchup here on Redeemer Radio, back to the SAC Friday Night Lights. We've got two programs with signature victories this week going up against each other head-to-head. The Bishop Dwenger Saints going into Chambers Field to take on the Northside Redskins. Of course, Bishop Dwenger with a great victory over Homestead and a late victory by the Northside Redskins over the Carroll Chargers. So very interested to see next week's matchup on Redeemer Radio. Remember, you can catch us online at RedeemerRadio.com or, of course, 106.3 FM.
Well, you guys do a great job, and great to have you, by the way, back with us, at least for our home games, and hopefully we can steal you away from Mama for maybe a couple of road games during the season.
I'm going to talk to management about that, Joe, see what we can
do. Just labor, right?
That's right.
Tigers back home next Saturday night under the lights. They'll face Lindenwood Belleville and USF on the road, again under the lights, 7 o'clock kickoff at Taylor University. It'll be 6:45, our pregame, next Saturday night on the road at Upland. Cougars won last year over the Trojans here at 42-0. Here tonight, big offensive display, 59-16, the final. St. Francis 1-0 on the season. Olivet Nazarene drops to 1-1. Special thanks to our studio producer, his name, Robert Scora. Until next Saturday night, Thanks for listening, everybody. So long till we talk to you from Taylor University.